Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to your Sunset Safari. Now, it's been a little bit of a while since I last spoke to you. I have been wassailing around the countryside, KwaZulu-Natal, the Eastern Cape, and the lamentable economic hub of Johannesburg, which is about 600 kilometers or 450 miles, basically behind where you're sitting now, that way. It is a joy to be back in the wilderness again. Things have not changed a great deal since I've been gone, but for the fact that there is a slightly green sheen over the areas where the grass is growing, and that, I believe, is a result of some rain that you had, about 12 millimeters, which works out at about half an inch. Not a huge amount of rain, but not bad for the middle of winter. Now, if you're wondering who on earth I am, my name is James Hendry. If you're wondering on earth what on earth you're watching something called Safari Live. We broadcast to you twice a day, 3 hours a day, from the wilds of the Greater Kruger National Park, the western fringes thereof, a little spit of land called Juma Private Game Reserve, which is where we are now. You are live, which means, well, of course you're live, otherwise you wouldn't be watching, but we are live as well, which means that we'd love to hear from you, so please do talk to us, hashtag Safari Live or questions at wildearth.tv. We have Jean Dre on camera, there he is, very nice thumb.
Thank you.
Professionally done. That'll be the last compliment he gets today. And then, of course, on the other vehicle, the inimitable, irascible, and highly excitable Brent Leo Smith, being filmed by Wim Doornbraak, a.k.a. Paul Kruger. He, too, is back from leave as of today. So, I think that's all I'm supposed to tell you, if I remember correctly. Let's go and see if we can find some lions. Now, I believe, for those of you who were watching last night, there was a fairly astonishing sighting of a poor buffalo being killed by the Nkuhuma pride, and so that's what we're going to go and see. Obviously the we're not going to see the kill because the buffalo died yesterday, but we will be seeing them eating it, hopefully, and also see the little cubs that I haven't seen for a little while, see how they've grown, see how many there are there. I believe there were 8 of them there yesterday, or 5 of them there yesterday, and they were hoping they were going to be 8, something like that. Anyway, we're hoping to see all of them now, which would be great. And that's basically all I have to tell you from an introduction point of view. Like I say, a very slight change, just a slight green tinge on the ground since I was last here, and that born of that little bit of rain that we had. So that's really nice to tie us over, of course, because now, as I'm sure Brent and Jamie have been saying during the course of the last 14 days or so while I've been away, we're going into the real business end of the dry season now. August, September, October, that's the real dry season, but that little bit of rain is really going to help the grazers as we go towards those very dry times. Distressing news that we haven't managed to find any of those hyena cubs, which were born not too long ago, probably about 6 weeks ago, so I'm a bit sad they haven't been found. Right, we're going to go quite along, quite quickly off towards the eastern side of the reserve, see if we can find those lions. While we do that, go and say hello to Brent and Viam, welcome him back from all of us, and I'll see you shortly. Let's move. And very shortly it was indeed. Brent is lurking about on the northern edges where the signal on Wendy remains, astoundingly, still fairly dodgy. One day we'll fix her, I suspect with a flamethrower. Anyway, that is how it goes. I tell you what else has changed while I have been gone is that the elephants have been doing severe damage to the bush. Now, I don't mean that in a negative way at all. People often refer to the damage that elephants do in a negative way. It's not negative, but they certainly are changing the landscape during this very dry season. And like I said to you before I went on leave, probably 7 or 8 times, they have kind of been on winter forage all of the summer because there's been so little in the way of long green grass, which they like to eat. And you can really see the difference. And just around the camp where we live, there's a beautiful fig tree, one of the very few examples of the common strangler fig around here, get quite a few of them on cheetah plains for some reason, and then as you go towards the rivers, quite a few more of them. It's been pushed over. I think not completely. It hasn't been completely destroyed. There's a mammal genre. Good grief, it's an impala. It's our first mammal, everybody. Our first mammal together.
I'll never forget this moment, James.
I will. Anyway, not a great impala sighting. Not a top quality impala sighting. There are a couple more here. And I suppose round about now, they should start, is that, I know this is not the best, off over there. They should start to show their pregnancy, of course. Most of these ewes will be pregnant, and it will be interesting to see what the recruitment is like this birthing or lambing season in November. By recruitment, of course, I mean, sorry, I've lost my earpiece, everybody. It's got attached to a piece of Velcro on my shorts. It's all very trying. By recruitment, I mean, of course, the birth. How many of them are going to give birth this year? And because of the dry season, I suspect there'll be fewer of them. And I wonder how many sort of spontaneous, it's not a really nice way of putting it, but spontaneous abortions there might be as a result of the dry season. They're all having a bit of a run now. Marvellous to see. Beautiful, Gendre. That might be your top shot. Well done. Close-up of Combretum apiculatum. Right, we're now going to go back to Brent Leo Smith for the next 3.5 microseconds. I'll see you shortly.
Welcome back. As you can see, we found a sunbathing family of dwarf mongoose. It's been a bit chilly today, and they're not big fans of the cold. And so they're using that termiteria as a sunbed. Oh, there's one right next to us, Fim. He's coming closer to look at us. Down next to this other termite mound. Hello, little guy. Oh, hello. Absolutely fascinating little carnivores. Oh, a bit itchy. Now they live in family groups with a dominant pair that do all the breeding. So only the alpha male and female breed, and only the alpha female gives birth. The rest of the business, it's their job to help look after the babies. And they disperse quite similarly to wild dogs, believe it or not. So you will have a dispersal of two females or two males into different businesses of mongoose. And I say business because that's the original collective noun for a mongoose. So I'm here in the sort of northwestern corner of Juma Private Game Reserve at the moment, and I'm just doing a double check on those leopard tracks I found this morning. So there was a young male leopard tracks. I think it could be Sindila, and I'm hoping that he decides to grace us with his presence. If not, I think I haven't been to Arethusa in a while. We might take a little trundle down there. Aaron Richards would like to know, mongooses or mongeese? Mongoose, if I remember correctly. There's one mongoose, many mongoose. So we checked the Aubrey's Road hyena dens this morning. Unfortunately, no hyenas. There's the entrance to one of the dens. But I am hoping that possibly that young male leopard came this way. Now, this is the second day, that we've rolled the lottery wheel on Aubrey's Road. Hopefully, this drive will be a little bit luckier than the last. Well, it already has been. We've got the dwarf mongoose. Oh, some sunshine. Looks like the clouds are dissipating. Means we should have a beautiful, clear day tomorrow morning. we can start, as James mentioned, we're starting to see the effect of that little 12 millimeters of rain we had a few days ago, and we are starting to see a little green flush on the grass. And the only thing that flushed before the grass was the baboon's tail. Pretty sure within the next 2 or 3 days, maybe even today, you never know, we might find one of them with their beautiful little lilac flowers. Now, of course, the dry season, and this is a very dry, dry season, it does make it a little bit easier for us to spot game. So there's not so much grass cover to hide in. And there we go. There's the baboon's tail that's already sprouting. Let's just check. No flowers just yet, but they can flower pretty quickly after a little bout of rain. There we go. And so 5 days ago, it just looked like little dry stumplets in the ground. Now you can see the green are coming out. A lot of the grazing species are going to be really happy for this little bit of green flush on the grass. I think in particular, the wildebeest will be quite happy. Hear a mob of arrow-marked babblers babbling away, and they move through the bush. It's a bird, for those of you wondering. And remember, guys, questions at wildearth.tv or hashtag Safari Live if you'd like to ask myself or James a question. And we'll, of course, do our best to answer it. And just in case you were wondering, believe it or not, we are live in the middle of the African bush, and I'm hoping we're going to find some spotted cats this evening. Hi, Brock. Brock is asking about some birds, in particular hummingbirds, and do we have any? We don't have any hummingbirds, Brock. We do have sunbirds, which is similar, but they're a little bit more robust. I mean, they are petite, but they are a bit more robust than the hummingbirds you guys get in North America. Let me just find a picture for you quickly, Brock. And I've saw a sunbird in my garden. It's the first time I've seen it in Juma. It's come for the flowering aloes, and it's incredibly beautiful, beautiful sunbird, called scarlet-chested. There we go. So you can see, it, like the hummingbirds, they are nectar eaters, but they are a bit more robust, and they spend less time on the wing, and they often will perch to fly. So there we go. That's the scarlet-chested sunbird. And I'm hoping we can put him on camera one of these days. We might have to go visit Inga's to find them feeding on the aloes. Okay, so no sign of that leopard coming out there. I'm going to check back towards the gate. So while I'm on my way to check this little corner of Juma, let's go see how Commander Bond is finding being back in the bush.
We haven't seen anything, have we, Jandre?
Not at all.
It's been really distressing. But Jandre, what's that over there?
I thought I saw a putty cat.
We've just stopped right here, everybody, and there was a lion. As you came across, we saw him, and he's sitting at Biffleshook Dam on the dam wall. Nice. I believe there was a male at the kill, and I suspect quite strongly that this fellow came across here. Oh, Lots of lions here. Dozens of them. Well, three. Two males. One female. I suspect they've come for a drink after their buffalo meal. Their Sunday lunch of buffalo. Oh, this is magnificent. Look at them, and they're not fast asleep. They will be soon, but they're not at the moment. Hello. How very good to see you. That's marvelous. What a way to start. Now, I, of course, have been totally out of the loop, so if you could help me identify who this fellow is exactly. I have been particularly bad at identifying our friends, the Birminghams. I am going to guess, and I'm more than happy to take correction, that this is Blondie. But I might be wrong. So please tell me if I'm talking nonsense. And of course also welcomed back with very similar coloured hair, of course, is Blondie the Lion, Kirsten McLennan-Smith, who agrees, she's in the final control, that this is indeed Blondie. Chandra, if you smell something a little off, it's not in fact the lions, believe it or not. It is my jersey, which seems not to have dried properly, and therefore smells, well, it smells a bit like dirty feet, really. We'll have to sort that out. He's got really pretty impressive hairstyle these days, don't you, fella? So I don't know if you saw the others, but there's another male and a female just behind him. They are, of course, fast asleep in exactly the position we want to drive to go down to see where the kill is, and especially to see if there are any little cubs around. But there they are. You can see they're doing not much, which, of course, if a lion has just had a heavy Sunday lunch of buffalo and apple crumble afterwards, well, that's what they tend to do. But like us, they like to have a bit of a snooze. This chap really... I think the flies might be bugging him slightly as he attempts to have his snooze. He's an impressive fellow. I'm just trying to discover, I think we can probably go round them by going behind this chap. Hello, Valeria. You say I'm absolutely going to melt when I see the cubbies. Well, I imagine that is probably true. And I'm looking forward to it greatly. He's really not having a good time with the flies. Now, everyone, I think these guys are going to hang around here and... So I'm going to suggest what we do is move on, not because there's anything wrong with these chaps, but because I just know that there are going to be lots of vehicles getting mobile fairly soon, and I want us to have sufficient time with the cubs before we have to leave. So if it's all the same to you, I'm going to try and skirt around him and then skirt past those other two as well. And we'll get Gendre up nice and close to the other two, around eye level, and see how he reacts to that lot. And then we can come back here, of course. I don't think they're going to go anywhere. And Emil, you want to know if this is near the Juma waterhole? It isn't. This is near the Biffleshoek waterhole, Biffleshoek Dam. Biffleshoek Dam is just over here. And we're about, I'd say, as the crow flies, only about 2 kilometers from the Juma waterhole, 2.5 kilometers or so, which is not many miles. Let's just see how they react here. I don't think they'll do anything. If they do, I'll just probably move on past. Ooh, this is a very scar-faced fellow. This is actually going to be quite a nice picture. Andre, will you let me know if you feel uncomfortable at all? We are very close to them, everyone. And we're almost at eye level. So I'm going to just talk a little bit more quietly. And this chap, is that the fellow that had the... It is. He's the chap who had the really bad skin infection, which seems to have cleared up quite nicely. As we always say, how remarkably resilient these animals are. This is fantastic, isn't it? Now we're only sitting about, 8 feet from them? And they can see, them breathing because they've been eating so much. She doesn't look that full-bellied. She also doesn't appear to be lactating. So one of the few Nguhuma lionesses that has not had babies. With her pink nose, I think she's the youngster. Again, it has been a little while. I just need to reacquaint myself with exactly what's going on here. And if you just, I'm going to ask that you have a listen. I'm going to be quiet and just see if you can hear the breathing of that big male lion. You hear him? Huge nostrils sucking in oxygen. So Angie, you say this is Birmingham boy number 3. Now the numbers, of course, I find quite difficult to understand, but yes, I definitely recognize him from that kind of flaky skinned, I don't know how many of you have watched Game of Thrones, but the kind of gray scale that he has on his belly there, that has definitely cleared up a lot. And Anne, you're in Alabama. You say the other one that we saw is not Blondie. You say it's Birmingham number 4. Now, I am perfectly happy to go along with that, but I'd love you to tell me how you knew that, if you don't mind. So, Anne, if you don't mind telling me how you knew that was Birmingham number 4, that would be greatly useful. It's wonderful having them at eye level, I've got to tell you. And Kat, nice to hear from you again. I always almost said nice to hear your voice, but of course I didn't hear your voice, did I? Kat, you say you can never get over how close we can get to them. I've got to tell you, it does amaze me fairly consistently as well. Every so often, especially when they kind of look up and, your eyes meet with the lion's eyes just sort of 8 or 10 feet away, it's then that you think, oh, we're actually very close to the apex wild predator out here, other than ourselves, of course. And that is, it's quite a primal thing, that. Just look at her belly there, and I think you can see that she's also, obviously now she's covering herself because she feels embarrassed, but she too has got that kind of, that looks like the beginnings of that skin infection that this Birmingham boy number 4 seems to have recovered from. She's looking up at some vultures, everybody. That's why she's looking up. Look at her eyes. Hello, Haley. As you're obviously watching ticks and, certainly you're watching a whole lot of flies flipping about this lioness, and you're saying, how come the ticks don't affect them in the same way that they affect house cats? Hayley, it's for the same reason that the ticks don't affect human beings from this area as they would if you came into this area and were bitten by ticks. It's simply because their bodies are used to the, I think it's rickettsia is what they call the bacterial disease that they give to you. And so these large wild cats, in the same way that the African wild cats and the cheetah and the leopard and all the animals out here, have a natural resistance to it simply through their experience of the disease and of the parasites that they inflict. And so, you know, if it's unlikely that you as a human being would get tick bite fever, which is what we call the disease you get from ticks out here, it's unlikely you'd get it twice from the same area. And that's why. So if you were to bring a wild cat into this, or a domestic cat into this area with all of its sort of, I don't like to say unnatural, but, you know, not wild medicine that they experience from birth, if you were to bring them into a wild area, yes, then if they get bitten by ticks, they're going to struggle. They're simply not used to it. All right, we're going to move on. There's that grey scale that I was talking about, probably some kind of a mange. And we're going to move on just quickly because I'm just a little bit worried that everyone else is going to get mobile and then we're not going to have as long of those cubs as we might have. Well, assuming they're there. Goodbye, beautiful lions. So while I try and find where those little cubs are, let's head across to Brent Leo Smith and find out how his tracking's going.
Well, unfortunately, that male leopard we were tracking this morning has, during the day, moved into Sibambili, so hopefully he'll come back soon. Sorry, one second. Let's see if... Oh yeah, James has got it. And we're going to go check towards Red Dam. Tingana was found in Elephant Plains this morning, but you never know, he might have moved towards that, and none of the guys in the west are out yet, so and hopefully he goes towards Red Dam. Red Dam seems to be a favorite spot of his. Tracks of that young male leopard. I've crossed west into Sibambili. I'll be leaving the area and crossing into Arethusa. Okay, so you never know. One of the reasons we're checking through here is also a favorite hangout of shadows. Oh, beautiful. In this light this afternoon, no, it of course land in the shade. And let's see if it pops its way into the sun. Cape glossy starling hiding. Oh no, we're not hanging around today. So this is an area that Shadow frequents, and we haven't seen Shadow and her cub for a while. Jamie was the last to see them, so it'd be really fantastic if we got to catch up with them. So, and I haven't been to Arethusa in quite a long time, so worth a little dabble around. I keep meaning to get to Arethusa Dam to see how dry it is. I always either see something or get distracted before we get there. This is a really, really productive part of Juma along this western area here. And we're about to pop out towards Impala Plains, a large open area. And I'm waiting. Hopefully we're going to find the herds of wildebeest and zebra on this new green flash shortly. Okay, here we are, Impala Plains. And there is nothing that I can see. Ba-dum-bum. Zip. Nada. Zilch. Apart from some grass, some trees. Okay, let's go check on Arethusa. Hi, Doodles. Doodles, I would like to see Cindy. Would love to see Sindile, and would like to know, still have his collar on, and when, if so, will it pop off? So, yes, he does have his collar on. When his neck gets to a certain size, it'll automatically pop off. So, can't give you an exact date, unfortunately. Okay, so now this is the main road. This is the boundary between Arethusa and Juma. We fortunately can traverse both properties. So it's just a nice big road to look for tracks on. Remembered Julia. Now Julia says, Brent, we forgot to answer the track quiz from yesterday with all the excitement of the lions hunting buffalo. Julia, it was a slender mongoose track, so just perfectly preserved in that little bit of mud, a slender mongoose. Okay, now we're on Arethusa. Time to jump on the other channel, see if we can get hold of anyone. Let's just check a little bit further down here first. Get deeper in where our radio communications are better. So James Richard's wondering, on slender and white-tailed mongoose, what is the size difference in the tracks? The slender is probably half the length and half the width of a white-tailed mongoose track. Yeah, I'm just listening to the radio. And again, everyone's getting moving. I'm gonna have to move to some higher ground before I can hear clearly. But we're nearly at Red Dam now. And Tingana really likes this area around this little drainage system that flows into Red Dam. Here we go, Red Dam. No Ellie's, I was hoping it might be Ellie's. Is there a leopard lying above? Oh no, there's a hippopotami. Lonely hippo. You can hear the tinking of a blacksmith plover hitting his hammer. Unfortunately, no sign of Mr. Tingana. Hopefully, I'll be able to get an update shortly on that. And there we go, there's the blacksmith lapwings. Oh, there. And we can hear it tinking. Here we go. So that's where they get their name from, that tink, 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 tink call. Okay. Chitra would like to know, do we find a purple-rumped sunbird in the Kruger? No, I don't think we do, Chitra. I'll have to check my Africa bird book, but I'm 100%, no, maybe not, I'm 99% they don't occur in southern Africa. I will check for you, though. I think they might, if they are an African sunbird species, they might be up to the north or to the west. And how useful that I am on the sunbirds. No, we do not get purple-rumped sunbird in southern Africa, so it must be, if it is an African species, it must be a east, west, or north African species. Okay. Time to check around the Murrikani. The Murrikani is this little river system that runs through Arethusa. I am going to have to do going down here. I want to get your wonderful questions. Just give me half a second. Yeah, I think I've perfected this. Voila. Always a good place to look for leopard tracks. Well, we continue our search down the Murrikani. James has managed to get in to where the Nkuhumas are busy feasting on a buffalo. So let's go have a look.
Well, here we are, everyone. We did manage to scrape our way in here. There was a Birmingham boy actually disturbing the best access into the sighting, so we don't have the best view, but it's not too bad. So the third Birmingham boy over here, and there, five little cubs. They're all kind of lurking in the drainage line there. Three of them in a pile, well, two of them in a pile there. Another two trying to suckle to the left. Oh, that's a wonderful shot. Two of them trying to suckle there, and then another one, a little one, there with his mum or her mum. This is just wonderful. Now, I'm led to believe, Brent, oh, here comes the other one. Brent reckons that these are not the same three that we found close to here, close to Buffleshoek Dam. He reckoned that these came from the area to the sort of north of Gallego camp, that very kind of difficult area, and we all suspected that there might be lions in there. Oh, look at that. We all suspected there might be lion cubs in that area, but we couldn't get in there in a vehicle to look. We didn't see any tracks. We walked around, they didn't find anything. And so he reckons these are those ones, because they look slightly bigger. They're definitely bigger than the ones, those tiny little things we were going to view just before I went on leave. And there are vultures flying all over this place. Hundreds of them there were. There we go. And hundreds of them have now spotted this thing. And the most common question we get about vultures is normally, you know, can they smell? Can they smell what's going on? And the answer is no, which is simply because they don't need to. You know, there's not too much cover often over these areas, and so they can see these things. But the smell assailing my nostrils at the moment is very powerful indeed, and not very pleasant. It smells of rotting buffalo and lion dung, basically. And if ever you've had the privilege of smelling lion dung, you will know that it is it's just offensive. That's amber eyes there. Little cubs all moving in, hoping for a suckle. It's wonderful, isn't that incredible? Now you can see beautifully here how they do cross suckle. They all tried to have a drink from the same mum. She didn't react at all. And so whoever is lactating, whichever female happens to be lactating, she will feed them quite happily. Almost for the good of the pride, you know. Ooh. You can hear lions coming behind us having a fight. There we go. There's a male and a female right behind us, Hendry. I think that's obviously where the other female was. I can try and move. I'm loath to, because they're in some very thick bush. So we're not going to move. We're just going to tell you that that's where they are. I just heard them growling at each other, and I wonder. Oh, look, goodness gracious. Hendry, off to the left. Here comes the other Birmingham boy, everyone. Now, the carcass is just behind this spikethorn thicket that he's just gone behind. He's coming across to the lionesses, though. Yep, we can VR. Everyone, we're going to put the VR on, so I'm going to present to that little ball of GoPros over there. I'm just going to give a clap. Right off to the front left, you can see a male lion. He's just marked his territory against that beautiful tamburti bush, and he's eyeing out the three lionesses and the five cubs. Now, of course, the greatest threat a baby lion cub faces is a male lion. But because he is part of the coalition that birthed them, one of the youngsters in the pride, look at the little one coming towards. Look at this. This is so special. This is just so special. Sorry, everyone, we can't move. We're just going to wait here and see what happens. Isn't this fantastic? Now the two little ones approaching the male. So he might be their father, he might not be. Chances are he isn't. He's got a 1 in 5 chance of being their, a 1 in 4 chance of being their father. And there he is going right to sleep there. Isn't this unbelievable? And even though he may well not be related to them, well, he will be related because he's related to the other members of the coalition, but he may or may not be their father, but because he is part of the coalition, he's not a threat to them. And you can see how they approached him, and I think that's just wonderful to watch. And if you look above us, still lots of vultures circling through the sky. You can just see probably dots, black dots moving around. And here come the little ones to the cub, to the dad, or to the big male. I'm going to play with his mane. Let's see how he reacts. This is always such a wonderful thing to see, because we normally, you know, associate male lions and cubs with a very negative impression of infanticide. That little one there is going to the loo. Oh, this is very special. So, in total, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 cubs, 3 lionesses, that's 8, and 1 male over here. Brilliant stuff. And now, little cub on the far left, front left, going off towards the buffalo kill. But we won't be able to see it get to the buffalo kill because we're just not in the right position. But we can try and move. We'll try and move. If this male moves, we'll try and move and get another view. Brilliant stuff. Perfect Sunday afternoon. Okay. Right, everyone, we finished doing our VR now. I can't move the car. I would love to have moved for you there. They didn't actually, I don't know if you saw, the GoPros were in exactly the wrong position. I don't know if you saw, but they approached him. He didn't react at all. And that's pretty normal. And now there's a little one. I don't know, can you even get a gap through there, Jean-André?
Yeah.
But there's a little one actually eating at from the carcass.
Nothing.
I'm going to try and move, everyone. And I also need to just try and find out how many vehicles are allowed in the sighting. Aubrey, come in. Aubrey, do you copy? Because we might have to move out. And Dave, come in, Dave. Dave, what's your position?
Jets, I will pull out for Dave.
Are you sure? Because I don't mind. Okay. Dave, make your way straight if you'd like to. Now here comes the other male behind us, Andre. And he's bringing the females, and they're all growling. They're all growling at him and her. Cubs running all the way in front of us. They've gone up the hill. We're in a slightly precarious position here. So we're sandwiched between them. Cubs have all gone up onto the bank. They've moved. 3 lionesses, male stood up, and that's as 2 behind us started to approach. You can see this chap is not happy in front of us. And I can hear an elephant moving off to the right-hand side there. Now, why they've had this reaction is bizarre. That's a Birmingham boy. It's another lioness from this pride. They were very cross, extremely unhappy. There's an elephant off, but that's not what they were growling at. It's not an elephant. The bushes breaking is the vultures jumping up and down in the trees, and they're breaking bits of branches that are falling onto the ground. Now let's see if the cubs come back. And that's really bizarre behavior. I have no idea what happened there. Yeah, I can hear the cubs. I know you can hear a vehicle, but I can hear the cubs now calling. Here goes a lioness, one of the mothers, going up to see them, maybe to retrieve them, bring them back down. So all five little cubs went running up the top of the bank there. There, you can hear them now, maybe. It's the best sound. There, you might just be able to see them now on the top of the bank. There they are, thinking about coming back, and there's that call, that noise they're making is reaffirming the social bonds that they have. And just sort of kind of comforting each other and making sure that, you know, everything's okay, everything's tickety-boo within the pride. A bizarre reaction they had to that other male, I don't know why they did that. Really quite strange. I think what we should probably try and do is get around a little bit that side. Once Abel's out of the sighting, that's the vehicle you can hear, and we'll try and move around and get a view up onto the top of the bank there. And maybe we'll get those beautiful cubs in a gorgeous afternoon light. Sorry, buddy, we're going to have to can that. I'm just going to have to help some people get into the sighting, and then we might have to leave. But I think we're okay. I'm just going to find out on the radio how many people are coming here. How many stations making their way to the sighting of the buffalo kill? Go ahead. Copy, how far out are you? Copy. Okay, it looks like we won't have to move out for the next little while, which is great. Let's move now, Hendry, I think, just before the other vehicle gets in here. And so maybe we'll get a view of the whole agglomeration. Anyway, our VR is off, everyone, so if you would like to resume questions, please do so. And I do apologize for the fact it's difficult to take the questions while we're doing the VR, but you're still getting the benefit of the sighting. So let's see if we can't ease our way through here and get a decent view. I'm trying not to destroy the VR camera. Hendry, of course, having a minor heart attack now. Not a cheap piece of equipment, is it, Hendry? Got a nice vulture. Yeah, I think we'll just ease forward. That's a lovely hooded vulture there, everybody. Deborah, I'm going to get back to you now. Dave, the cubs have gone up onto the bank. I'm just trying to get into a position. I would go to the area behind me, and I think you'll get another view there. And then there also is another male and female just to your right-hand side now. Deborah, you say that the vultures on the ground where you are in Tennessee have the disturbing habit of when they feel threatened, or when they are feeling threatened, they will they will run up to you and projectile vomit. Do the vultures here do that? I'm going to try and get as close to underneath this hooded vulture as we can, and we'll see if it projectile vomits onto Hendry. At this stage, no projectile vomit. I'm being slightly facetious. Deborah, I've heard of that behavior. I haven't heard of it in the context of African vultures, though. Hendry, I'm afraid that's as best I can do for you. I don't think we're going to see those cubs because they've all gone into the bushes on the top there. But you can still get the lions, can you? So it might be worth just waiting here and seeing if the little ones don't come down. Ah, Fiona, lovely question from you. Fiona, you say, is it possible for two males to father the same cubs in the same litter, or cubs in the same litter? And the answer, Fiona, is we're not really sure, to be honest. That vulture didn't projectile vomit it, but it did fly away. We don't know, Fiona. We do know, like you say, it happens with dogs. We don't know for sure whether it happens with lions or not, and we don't know if it happens with leopards. I think it's unlikely that it happens with them, mainly because when a female comes into estrus, her estrus cycle is normally monopolized by one male. So whereas a leopard will often mate with multiple males during the course of an estrus cycle, it doesn't really happen with the lions. They've gone, that when that male there got up, everyone got up and started growling, and they skedaddled up to the top there, yeah. I was just explaining that to Dave from Cruise Camp in Biffles Hook. What happened? So, if you could help me again, everybody, we've had Birmingham boy number 4 and number 3, I think. Which one is this? It must be 1 or 2, I suppose. Not so, Jean-André.
5
is a war indeed. Just speaking of projectile vomiting, the smell, of course, from where we're sitting so close to this deceased buffalo. I'm amazed that it has rotted as fast as it has here. It's not a delightful stink. Although, I suspect most of the green cloud that is assailing this particular area is probably brought on by the lion's dung rather than the actual rotting of the flesh.
And your jersey.
And my jersey. Combined, that's a very good point, Jean-André, combined with the stink of my jersey. One should, of course, allow these things to dry rather than putting them wet back into your into your cupboard. Ooh, Ruth, very nice question all the way from Gauteng, from where I drove this morning. You say, do lions have smelly urine in the same way that possibly house cats? You probably smelt house cats' urine, which is disgusting. No, not really, no. I mean, they say leopard smell urine smells like buttered popcorn. I don't think it smells like that at all, but I mean, I get the idea. Lions, no, not very smelly at all. I mean, I guess it must be because that's how they mark their territory, but not to us, no. It's not like that horrible smell of domestic cat urine, which is really very unpleasant and can't get it out once you've got it. Right, well, for as long as nobody else is coming to the sighting, I think we'll probably remain here and just see if those cubs don't eventually pop down from up the bank there. We might be able to slowly make our way actually up there. Ah, now a number of you say that this is Blondie, the Birmingham. Please, again, can you try and tell me how you know that? Because he's got a much blacker mane than the one I misidentified earlier on. Of course, their manes will change colour. So I'm sure he was blonder than he is now. And now all is peace again. With the cubs, the kids are away, and so the adults can snooze. And whatever threat they felt from that other male and female has dissipated as they too have fallen into a soporific Sunday slumber. These two vultures are smiling at each other, Gendry. Engaged in a very intimate sort of probably cleaning of each other, maybe even a courtship display. Isn't that nice? There's the two hooded vultures. Look at them. That is so cool. Hello, kitty, kitty, bang, bang. Nice to hear from you again. You say, are vultures still endangered, and do they make any sounds? They are absolutely still endangered. Their numbers are plummeting. The hooded vulture, not so much. The genre there, the other two lions moving now behind. Excuse me, kitty. Kitty, the situation with vultures, the hooded vultures and white-backed, probably not endangered, but their numbers are definitely going down. They're not improving at the moment, and we think that that's probably due to their collection for traditional medicine, which isn't really a problem. It's not ideal. Here come these two. Oh, I thought they were going to move. They're not. She might be an estrus, of course. That's why he's following her so closely every time she moves. But kitty, they do make noises. Mostly they hiss at each other. They make a sort of hissing noise, especially if they're fighting over food. But what I'm going to do is just play the call. Gendre, of course, just tracking another hooded vulture. Let me just quickly try and play you. There we go. Beautiful. Wonderful. That's fantastic. That's another hooded vulture. I'm going to play the call of the hooded vulture. They will have a call. I'm not going to lie to you, I don't think it's going to be like listening to a robin, but here it is. That's white-headed, hang on a sec. I've just got to find him, there he is. So that's the hooded vulture you can hear there. I'm playing it very quietly because I don't want to sort of disturb them and confuse them. That's interesting. I didn't realize it was quite that noisy. Yeah, you can hear that hissing. And then I'll play the white-backed, or white, yeah, white-backed's got a nasty hiss. There. That's the white-backed vulture. That's the sound you normally hear. So not an attractive sound. There's that hiss. Now, Hendry, can you see that one that just came down? Now what he's doing, he's not anywhere near the buffalo. He's come down onto the ground, I suspect, and you won't believe this, to eat the dung of the lions. Ugh, that's exactly what he's eating. Well, I guess that's why the bush doesn't smell like lion dung everywhere. Oh, doesn't that look nice, Hendry? Oh, delicious. Yes, I'm not sure I've ever been so close to projectile vomiting in my life. Oh. Isn't he an amazing creature? Here comes another one. This is fantastic. And now the lions are coming down towards them. So just keep on them, Hendry. I think you'll probably find they'll fly off. Here come the lions. They're behind the vehicle though, so we can't see them. But if they come too much closer, that vulture will fly. Now, this male here is growling again. and the lions have lain down. Anyway, worth watching this vulture. This is the best vulture sighting I've had for a long time. Here comes another one. Right behind the bush there, I'm afraid. Just going to get hold of Aubrey. Go ahead, Orbs. You sure? Orbs, go ahead. I'm just going to try to help Aubrey to get into the sighting, everyone. That is too spectacular, isn't it? Delicious. Oh, lots to eat, eh? Jean-André?
Yeah.
Nothing gets wasted here in the bush, does it? So, Kitty, just back to your question about these vultures. You know, for a very long time, I thought there were lots and lots of vultures, or there were lots and lots of vultures when I started. If something looked like it was going to die, hundreds of vultures would emerge into the air. That's 15 years ago, 16 years ago now, and things have definitely changed. Not sure what we're going to do about it. While I ponder the mysteries of vulture conservation, let's head across to Brent Leo Smith. He has managed to arrive at Arethusa.
So there we go, we're with an African fish eagle that's hunting for catfish in the mud. Oh, there's another one coming in, Vim. Oh, it's a juvenile. Can see the coloration. There we go, we can see the Arethusa waterhole is incredibly dry at the moment. And it's basically a mud hole. And there is a poor hippo that is using the mud to protect himself from the African sun. There we go. And if you look carefully, what looks to be mud all around him is actually catfish that are stuck in the mud. Every now and then you just see a tail flick. There we go, at the base of the hippo's tail, there's a catfish moving. It is incredibly, incredibly dry. You know, the worst drought in South Africa since 1992. Now I'm hoping there's about five or six fish eagles around us, and I'm hoping some others come down to land. Sorry, I'm just keeping quiet. I thought I heard something. Down below us, yeah. I can't really make out what it was. Oh, no, I'm not sure what it was. And that fish eagle's taken off, but there's a... always, I've lost sight of it now. Just move forward a little bit. Incredibly beautiful bird flying above it. I have to wait for him to get a bit closer again. Let's have a look at this poor hippo and the poor catfish trapped in the mud. There we go. You can see not much room to move there. You can see the movement of the catfish behind there. All those things that look like mud are actually catfish. Now some of them will be able to burrow deep into the mud and they'll be able to survive the drought like that. Others might get stuck at the top. Oh, there's a red-breasted swallow. That's the bird we're looking for. Very pretty. Oh, he's coming straight at us. really incredible bird. I do love the swallows. Now, I'm going to just sit here and wait and listen for a while. Maybe the fish eels will come back down. There we go. Fish eagle calling in the distance. Incoming. There we go. Yeah, the fish eagle's calling. Now, it's quite uncommon to have congregations like this unless there is a sort of drying water source like this. And there you go, listen to them call. Of course, now they're being quiet. So from a bird of prey that likes its meal relatively fresh to one that'll even eat dung.
And certainly it dung it is eating. That hooded vulture is devouring the great sort of steaming piles of evil-smelling black lion dung that there is all over the place here. It is quite foul in the extreme. Wouldn't you say, Jean-André? You're feeling hungry, are you? I'm not sure I'll eat again for the next month. You might just be able to hear them landing there in the trees quite heavily. They don't land lightly like many birds do. They really do thump down onto the trees. This is incredible. He's so close to us now. Now if he comes near this kill, he's going to be in trouble. Now the male lion's got his head up, and that's because he's noticed this vulture coming towards his meal. So they don't mind when they don't have an issue with the vultures consuming their dung. They're not so chuffed when they are not doing that, when they are threatening what is going to be his Sunday supper. With a golden light on them now, and that vulture. And that was not created by any lion movement, that was created by a branch falling off the tree in which another vulture was sitting, and everyone got a fright. Wonderful stuff. And now the lions are back to sleep. Everyone's relaxed. I just wish those cubs would come back down. Hendry, why don't we just try and do a little bit of a maneuver up here? We might be lucky. I suspect we won't be, but let's try. They're just basically everybody over there behind that jacket plum tree there. I think on the top. So let's just... Oh. Apparently we can't move now. Sorry, everybody. We'll move shortly. We're just a bit worried about losing signal. Becca, I think if our signal's strong, we probably will be okay. I'm just going to get a confirmation from her. She's talking to me now. Okay, we're going to try and move forward. If we do lose signal, then we'll come straight back here. Okay, Brent is doing a Facebook Live thing, so we can't cut to him, and that's why we just need to be a bit more careful of our signal here. It is a slightly dodgy signal area. You all right there, Jean Ray? Okay, sorry about that, everybody. We had to try. Here come the other lions. I've been saying that many times. They're moving. They'll probably lie down almost immediately. Now, listen to the growl. This male is growling. I don't know why he would be so cross. And then they lie down again. It's bizarre. I'm really not sure why he would be growling like that. Hello, Michelle, you're in Johannesburg, watching on a Sunday afternoon, and you want to know, oof, isn't that beautiful? Look at those eyes. Well spotted, Hendry. Very nice. You want to know how many lion kills I've seen? From start to finish, really not that many. I'd say maybe 10. So not that many considering the amount of time that I've spent out here. That's because they largely happen during the night when I'm sleeping in my bed. I also think that lions kill a lot of impala that we don't see. Because a pride like this, of course, will devour an impala in less than half an hour. So if they kill something during the night and we don't happen to actually see it, you just find them in the morning looking like they've had a bit of a meal, but you don't actually see it. It's only when they kill animals like this rotting buffalo over here, or a zebra, for example, that you do see them. Amelia, you say, interestingly, I'd love to know why you're asking this question. You say, if we've seen one such kill, is there any educational reason to see it another kill? Amelia, I would say absolutely, because you can't tell everything you want to from watching just one kill. You can't tell exactly what they're... Excuse me, I'm just trying to move so I can see you. You can't tell exactly what the hunting strategy is. You can't tell exactly how they coordinate their kills. There's the other lioness. You see her there? I've just seen her tail flicking there. Hendry can just see her, so he's not going to turn the camera towards her just yet. So now we've got everyone accounted for. Amelia, we don't know what they eat all the time. We don't know how that is that they coordinate their hunts. We don't know how much. We still don't know precisely how much the males are killing, how much they're helping, how much they're eating, how much they're stealing. It varies from lion to lion. Absolutely, it makes a huge difference in the same way that it makes a difference to our educational knowledge of lion behavior, watching them mark territory, for example. It's the same with watching them kill. It tells us something new just about every single time, and that is no better evidenced than when we, especially on Safari Live, will give you a fact about something that we've read in a book. We'll watch these animals and they'll behave completely in an opposite way. Completely normal, happens all the time, but it just shows you that we just don't know everything. So yes, absolutely, hugely valuable to watch as much behavior as we can. In the case of their sleeping, though, they do a lot of that, and we know that they're very good at it. And these two seem to be perhaps a mating pair, moving slowly closer towards the kill, edging towards it. Oof. There was a very large vile-looking fly that just landed in these parts, but it's thankfully flown off. And all around us now you can hear the black-headed orioles and the white-browed scrub robins, which I haven't heard for now for many days. And all is complete peace here. And were it not for the profoundly appalling smell in the air, I might nod off myself. It's such a beautiful Sunday. Oh, that's a male. Male. Jean-André just spotted the other lion. He's just going to swing the camera around now. I think there are two of them there, Jean-André. One, two, three, four, five. There you can just see where Jean-André is pointing the camera now. You can see the male lion sleeping there. Can you imagine how easy it would be to stand on his tail if he was fast asleep and not flicking his tail like that in such bush? You can see now why lions are the colour that they are. I think that might be... I saw a lioness there earlier, but it might not be. It might just be that male. Let me just move around a bit. Because that is a wonderful picture there, isn't it? Just brilliant of a hooded vulture. We've had some incredible hooded vulture shots today. I'd rather I quite like him to look at us, Jean-André, if you could make him look at us, but preferably not projectile vomit, that would be great. Thank you. Oh, not projectile vomit, but very good. The usual story, as Brian would say, whenever I see an animal, it feels the need to relieve itself. Gerda, yes, it is really impressive. You say you love that blue line around their eyes. It's certainly more attractive than the lion dung that is covering the lips of that vulture. Yes, very pretty blue line. But imagine having that all over your mouth. Ugh, I mean, they are really... That is the bottom of the pile. When you were forced to eat lion dung for a living, you know that you did something dreadful in a previous life. Well, that vulture doesn't seem to mind gazing into the blue sky. Satisfied, full crop. Nice also that you can see the ear opening there. You see that behind the eye. That is the ear. That's such a cool shot, everybody. And you can see exactly why it's called a hooded vulture. Looks like a... Well, looks like a sort of recalcitrant teenager with a hoodie. That's beautiful. Wow. And just watch the very reptilian membrane going across the eye instead of blinking fully. See that? All the reptiles have got, or many reptiles have got that ability. As interestingly do elephants. They have a membrane that they can push across the eye rather than blinking. This is fantastic. It's listening, you see. And looking, because there are a whole lot of vultures above it. So it's twisting its head up to look. And there are much bigger vultures coming in now. The big white-backed vultures are starting to move in. and they'll wait very patiently for the off chance of picking up some of this buffalo.
No, we can't quite get there,
I'm afraid. Gendre is at quite an angle. Anyway, let's go back to the lions. Right, I think Brent is back online, so what I am going to try and do is drive up the bank a bit and we will lose signal, but let's see if we can't get into a position there where we can see the cubs. And while we do that, let's go back across to Brent and see what he has managed to find.
So we're exploring the southern end of the Arethusa airstrip. I was hoping to find my friendly neighborhood side stripe jackals. I can't see them just yet. We get no luck. We're going to start heading back towards the Juma, and hopefully Karula is going to make an appearance in the Mawati. And I'm just checking. It's quite cold this afternoon, so the jackals should be lying out in the sun rather than in the shade. They do move around a bit, so they might not be here today, but I'm really hoping they are. No jackals. How sad. Well, maybe we'll find them tomorrow. Been pushed into very, very narrow strip. The property to the east of us here called Hoffman's, and then that narrow strip of Juma. And Salahesh, the female leopard, has been coming there, pushing Shadow into a very narrow corridor between her and Karula. So it's going to be really fascinating to see what happens with the leopard female leopard dynamics in the next couple of months. So we haven't seen any tracks. Now, I know James was talking about a little bit earlier that often the books are wrong, and that's quite true. So they're generalizations, but animals don't read the books, so they can do whatever they want. And Sarah in the UK is wondering, what's one of the strangest animal experiences I've ever had, and that sort of goes outside of the guidebooks? I think in the savannah, it has to be with cheetah. So there was not much data, and there still isn't much data on cheetah fights. And we saw two coalitions of male cheetah. They fought for 9.5 hours. And take a break, fight again, take a break, fight again. And in most of the books it says, well, cheetahs don't really fight, da da da. But those male cheetah went at each other for hours upon hours. Another strange one that I didn't find in any of the guidebooks, although when I was in Gabon it was apparently common knowledge, is that there's a monkey species, a big monkey species, sort of double the size of a vervet monkey, called a red-capped mangabey. Very cool monkey. Now, the red-capped mangabey, I think I might have a photo of one for you here, goes into the mangroves on coastal Gabon, and it actually goes down onto the mangrove roots and picks oysters and feeds off oysters. I found that absolutely incredible. Do I have it on this one? Might have it on here. So I found that really, really incredible, that mangabeys are going and eating oysters. And we thought we were the only primates that ate oysters. Oh, there we go. I'm sure I've got a picture of a red-capped manga bee somewhere out to show you. There we go. And there's a red-capped manga bee in the mangroves. So on the root of a mangrove, this is during low tide, obviously. But they would go up into the deep water and sort of put their arms completely down into the water and rip oysters off the mangrove roots. Very, very pretty monkey, the red-capped manga bee. One of the funniest things I ever saw is those manga bees, well, they were fishing for oysters. One misjudged a jump. And mangroves are not very strong. They break quite easily. And there are some monster crocodiles there. And this manga bee misjudged the jump and it grabbed the branch and it fell into the water. Now, the only way I can describe the look on that monkey's face was complete panic. Now, if a small child
Hi, everybody. Sorry, we're very inconvenient to have lost Brent there. We're just trying to get into a position. We did find the cubs again. They're up here with their mum. And we'll just get a view. They're not that relaxed. So I'm going to stop here. This is not going to be the best view, but you will be able to see them. They were just getting a little bit nervous with us being here, which is just a testament to how little time they've spent around vehicles. And there were one or two branches spiked up, and so they knocked against the steering column. So they just moved a little bit away. Now you can see they're completely relaxed now. Isn't that amazing? Oh, it's wonderful. The light is so stunning. Now they've spotted something. You can see the ones just behind there, heads up, ears looking, ears listening. Ears can't look, can they, Gendre? They do more sort of the hearing thing. There they are. Now, I think they might come back to Mum, who's just behind this thicket that we were looking at there. And if they do that, we should get a good view of them. They're going to sleep. Even at this age, they're excellent sleepers, lions. Wow. Isn't that amazing? Perfect winter golden light and lion cubs. Not a bad way to start off this work cycle at what we call a job. We're just going to let them relax a bit, then I might try and ease forward slightly, which might give you a better view. But let's just wait for now. You can see that one is now completely and profoundly and utterly relaxed. Still those spots. And nodding off. It is a very soporific afternoon. Especially when you're full of buffalo, roast buffalo. If you have just joined us, We've been very privileged to spend just about our whole afternoon here with these lions, the Nkuhuma pride, and their five cubs. There's still three cubs, not, well, I'm going to say missing, but that doesn't mean anything negative. They're just not with the pride yet. They're not old enough to be moving with the pride. And there's a buffalo kill down below us. When we watched it being killed yesterday, I didn't, but many of you did. the buffalo is probably about 50% eaten now. And these little cubs, although they're definitely all still suckling, will absolutely sample meat at this stage. And they'll wean completely only at 6 months, and I reckon we've got lion cubs here of about 8 weeks, and if I'm not mistaken, probably around, must be about 12 weeks, 3 months now, I think. We were asked, just listen, kitty, 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 bang, bang, if you're still with us. I just heard the sound of white-backed vultures shouting at each other. But they've stopped now. Yeah, they're coming a little bit closer, these chaps. Jandra, what I'm going to do is just depress the clutch and I'll try and get you a little bit closer. They look pretty relaxed. If they do move, everyone, I don't want you to worry. They will come back, and if they do react, I'll just switch the car off again. They will get used to us. Their mother has not reacted in the slightest. So we will just try and move. Let's watch their behavior. See, they're looking. They look pretty relaxed. In fact, they're coming back towards the mother. Chandra, I'm going to wait here. I think it's going to be worth just sitting here. They may well come out into the open now. James Dungan, what a great question you ask. Why do they have spots or rosettes, but like leopards do when they're born, and why do they go away? James, it's got everything to do, and I'm pretty sure that this is true, with where they live as adults versus cubs. When they're little, much like leopards, they live inside thick drainage lines, in amongst thick bushes, and so they want to have a dappled kind of outline that breaks the outline so that they can hide in the sort of they can hide in the dappled light of thickets and bushes, and the spots help with that. When they get big, though, no amount of spotting is going to hide a lion because they're enormous, and so they go this tawny color, which is really a great color. It's a great color for them to be, especially in the winter time, because they're the same color as the winter vegetation. So that's why they're savanna hunters. They're not sort of thicket hunters in the same way that leopards are. Isn't that a lovely shot? Eating a bit of sneezewood there, and I don't know if you've... Those are those multi-leaved bushes that they're biting on there. And interestingly, if you cut the wood of those trees, or you scrape it, a bit like a sort of scratch patch. I can hear the big male growling again. I suspect those mating pairs possibly moving back towards the kill. We'll keep an eye there. But if you have ever had those pretty disgusting things called, you know, those kind of polystyrene type cheese flavored chips, if you like, or crisps, that's what that plant smells like when you scratch the wood. And I wonder if, rather like young human children, these young lion cubs don't enjoy the taste of artificial cheese. Look at that. Isn't that lovely? Yeah, they're all coming back to mum now. You can see very clearly the two different ages, or maybe you can't, but... Hello, Matthew in England. You want to know if the mum and dad clean the cubs, or if the cubs clean themselves. Well, you can see them cleaning each other there a little bit. Oh, so tired. But they do clean themselves, but their mums will also clean them. Dad's not so much. John, if you go slightly to the right there, You will see those two there are kind of engaged in a bit of allo grooming. It's what we call it, Matthew. And yes, it's a bit of play fighting, but that's also, they were, just before we looked at them, they weren't being quite so bitey. They were licking each other. And so they clean each other a bit. Fathers, Matthew, will have nothing to do with cleaning them. But their mums will, if they get covered in gore and that sort of thing. There you go. They get covered in gore from that buffalo, for example, then they will certainly be cleaned by their mums. Now, what I want you to notice, Chandra, if you can, sorry to huck you, but if you can go a little bit back towards there, that one, that's a younger one. And you can see a slightly rounder face, slightly downturned ears. The ears are just not quite as erect as the slightly older ones. So tired. Isn't that sweet? Oh, it's wonderful. Robin, a very good question, to which the answer is yes, there is a reason why the big cats have round pupils and the smaller cats have slit pupils. I have very distressingly forgotten what that reason is, but there is a reason, and it's got to do with light, and one of them lets in more light than the other, if I'm not mistaken. But one of you very kind viewers told me once, and I have, on account of, I don't know, but so many things you've taught me, I've forgotten what it is, but there is a very good reason for it. So I'm going to throw it back at you, Robin, I'm sorry about that, but one of our viewers, I've no doubt, will be able to tell you. If we do not sort that out, I will do some research at the end of the drive and try and tell you. It was a very good question. This is just, I mean, this is spectacular that we have had this amount of time with these little cubs on our own. We are so lucky. I know the view's not the best, but I don't want to move because we're quite close to them. All right, everybody, we're going to have to move out of here. There are a few people coming into this. No, we're not. No, sorry. The next person's 20 minutes out. Just going to quickly talk on the radio, everyone. Mike, it's Aubrey and I here. I'm not sure if Tax is making his way here. He indicated that he might. But otherwise, I will happily move out when, as soon as the next station gets here. We're probably about 20 minutes to sundown. So we won't be viewing them after dark, obviously. In fact, after sunrise, sunset, we won't be viewing them. Now, I'm just trying to get a view behind us to see if the lions are on the kill. I don't think they are, but let's spend the time with these little ones. Chandra, would you like me to go back a little bit? Would that help you? Or was that just going to put the bushes in the way?
I could get a slightly better shot on that one's face, but...
Okay. Let me move slightly backwards, everyone. Then you'll... Yes, that's not the best shot. Now, although they are reacting when we start the car, I don't think it's a bad thing. The mother's certainly not reacting at all. They'll get used to the sound of the vehicles, and I think that's positive. Is that right? A bit more? Forward?
Maybe just pass the panga and we can get that wrong.
There you are. Hey? There we go. Beautiful. That is so cool. Now, I don't know if you can see there, but their ears are more upright than the younger ones. Gosh, we have been lucky. Every time it looks like we might have to move out, somebody else does, and we can spend a bit more time here. And who wouldn't want to spend time with little lion cubs? Ah, now, Windy23, you say that the slit versus round pupils have got to do with ambush versus sort of coursing prey, hunting strategy. So ambush predators would be something like a house cat, I guess, if you imagine it ambushing a hapless Cape Robin in a garden, for example. It might have, I'm not sure how that would help it. I don't buy that, Windy. I'll tell you why I don't, because a lion and a leopard are absolutely ambush predators. They're not coursing predators. Yes, there's a very brief chase, but it's no longer than an African wildcat would chase, say, a Franklin fall. In fact, it might actually even be less. So, yeah, that I have heard that before, and I don't buy it. I think much more likely is the other one we've had from Janet, which is that the slit-eyed cats are active day and night, not just nocturnally. The reason I'm looking confused about that is because the leopards here do a huge amount of hunting during the middle of the day, and they have most definitely got round pupils. So basically, the smaller cats, from the genus Felis, they've got the slit eyes, the African wild cats, the servals, the caracal, I think, also has got slit-eyed pupils. The big cats from Panthera, the tigers, the jaguar, the leopard, and the lion, they've got round pupils. Those are two theories. Either of them could have merit, and maybe they don't have any merit. I don't know. I'm not convinced completely by either, but both of them may or may not hold some sort of water. Maybe it's got to do, rather like Windy said, maybe it's got to do with the fact that certainly some predators or some prey don't move. So if you look at a house cat catching a bird, for example, the bird is often, I suppose, unaware, even though the ambush strategy is very similar as it is with a big cat. I guess a big cat's prey might become aware of it sooner and it might start to run, but nah, you know, I'm just not convinced about that. There's another vulture flying in. Right, the sun is now starting to peep down over the horizon. I'm going to do one more reposition. We'll see if we can get another nice view of the little cubs, and then we're going to move down. We can watch the adults for a bit longer, and then we'll move out. While I try and reposition, let's head across to Brent Leo Smith, who I've no doubt is also glowing gold in the light of the setting sun.
Oh, Commander Hendry. So, wait, let's, what did Jamie say? James and his waxing lyricals. We're heading down towards the Mwashi River. And we haven't seen any sign of Karula coming out. So I'm just double checking. It's about the third time I've driven the Mwashi in the last while, hoping that the Queen will make herself available for an audience. And if you're new, the Queen is of course a Karula, She's the dominant female leopard on Juma. She's got two wonderful little cubs at the moment, Shongile and Hosana. Shongile means exquisitely beautiful, and Hosana means little prince. And of course, Karula means peaceful. Oh, we got a big troop of baboons running ahead of us. The Chakma baboon. Let's see if we can get a view of them. They might head out to an open air on the other side there near Twin Dams. Now the fact that they are not making lots of noise, shouting from the treetops, means that there's no leopards around here that they've spotted. I really enjoy baboons. They're quite fascinating to watch. These ones, we don't see them too often in Juma, so they're not the most relaxed around the cars. But they are relaxing quite quickly. They're becoming far more relaxed. When we first saw them, they just used to take off. And see, now they jog off, and then if we stop, they walk. Now, they are, can be incredibly funny creatures, but not a creature to be trifled with. A big male baboon, they're called dog baboons, the big males, their canines are longer than a lion's. Not as thick, obviously, but in lengthwise, longer than a lion's. And it's very few animals that will fight with baboons. Leopards sometimes specialize in hunting them, as well as I've seen lions hunt them, but it's in your interest not to wrestle with a baboon. Well, that looks like they're all... I was hoping they're going to be out in the open. There they are. So I just want to stop driving behind them, because they think I'm chasing them, and just go the other way, away from them. Now, they're heading down towards the Mwati River, which is perfect spot for them to spend the evening. They like the big jackalberry trees, like these ones coming up on the left, is sort of their favorite spot to sleep. Okay, I'm just gonna speed up, get around the head of them. Whoop-ba. I'm trying to give them a bit more space so they feel comfortable and they start relaxing around the vehicles. I'm sitting there, then, directly below the sun. Here we go. There they are. And James Richard is wondering, do baboons ever commit infanticide? They definitely do. They can be quite aggressive towards other baboons. Where are the others now? It looked like there were a reasonable amount of them, about 30 or 40. Now, they are the complete omnivores, and impalas really try to stay away from them when they have their babies. Those big male baboons have a taste for baby impala. Okay, they seem to be calming down a bit. I'm going to see if I can get a tiny bit closer. It's always important to do it in little increments rather than bear straight at them. And also keeping the vehicle moving slowly and steadily. I'm hoping they don't run too fast. No, they're moving a bit too fast, unfortunately. We might get a gap of them through there. Off they go. Okay, so while the baboons move off to the south, let's go spend the last little bit of this golden light with those incredible Inkahumas.
They go flat, I think.
Now, everybody, there are those beautiful little cubs who've stuck their heads up, but they are not alone here, and their heads are up for a very slightly, well, interesting reason. Almost invisible to me, sitting where I am here, are two lions. The mating pair came right up the bank behind us. They decided that they were very relaxed there, and so that's where they've gone to sleep. Gendre took a rather amusing photograph of himself with them that I'm going to convince him to show you just now. But it really is quite impressive. They are so close to us. And they came up here of their own accord. We didn't move. They just came and lay there. That is very close. I can't really move. I suppose we could go forward and do a sort of 300 point turn, which we might have to fairly shortly. Phil, here's a nice question from you, one that is extremely easy to answer. You say, do I ever have the urge to reach out and touch one of the big cats as they go past me? Phil, no. I don't ever have that reaction at all. I feel that touching a lion as he walked past me would probably result in my losing my hand. And I feel that very strongly, and so no. I certainly, when I see the cubs, yes, I almost always want to get out of the car, go and pick one up and see what it feels like. That, of course, would be extremely stupid, and therefore I have never done it. I did hear an apocryphal story once of a ranger guide who found a lion's den by mistake, and he thought it was very clever of him to actually retrieve one of the cubs from the thick reeds in which they were sitting. And unfortunately for him, Mum came back as he was doing this, and so he showed this mewling cub to his guests as the mother emerged at a fairly substantial speed, making a tremendous noise. He dropped the cub, obviously, and jumped back in the car. That's a profoundly stupid thing to do, and one that thankfully I have never done and will never do. There they are. Try and get Mike into this position, and well, let's just sit here for a little while. And Olive, you're 5 years old and you want to know, do these little babies play with each other? Olive, they play with each other all the time, and I know they're different ages, but it's just the same as I suppose you might like to sometimes play with a 7-year-old child or maybe even a 3-year-old child. You know, you'll sometimes play with kids who are older than you and sometimes play with kids who are younger than you. It's the same things with the lions. They like to play with each other, and they're very close in age, you know. When they're adults, you won't be able to tell the difference in the age between them at all. They're so close in age. Very, very good question. Alice, you want to know about whether or not why these cubs don't come to the vehicles like hyena cubs do. I don't know. I really don't know, because lion leopard cubs don't do it either. And I said I thought it was because I remember being asked this about the leopard cubs, and I remember me saying that the hyenas are so confident and that's why. But lion cubs don't do it. They never show the same level of curiosity, and that's very interesting. I don't know the answer to that, Alice. Listen, we're going to have to move out of the sighting now. So I'm just going to quickly get on the radio with Tex. Texan, come in. Because I don't know if he wants to try and come here. Tex, do you copy Tex? Tex, confirm you're making your way here. Yeah, Tex, the cubs are up on the bank here. I'm not sure you're going to get a big Land Cruiser up here, but the adults are down with the kill. I think it'll be fine for the next little while. Okay, everyone, we're going to leave now. And while we move out, I think it's going to be probably a better idea if we can go to Brent. Tucker, you're four, just four. Thanks for asking a question. I just missed it, so I'm going to quickly ask Rebecca to give it to me again, and we're going to move out and we're going to hand you over to Brent while we get out of this rather difficult situation. Oh, Tucker, you want to know if they have soft fur? Tucker, the little ones do, yes. I can just see that. The big ones don't, though. It's not very soft, and I felt a big one once when they, unfortunately, it had died. But if you feel that fur, it's quite coarse. It's quite kind of rough, but the mane is quite soft. All right, we're going to go back across to Brent, everyone, and we're going to try and extricate ourselves from what is a fairly close situation.
Dams, but not yet. So as you can see, we're having some gremlins, and it's quite strange.
Doing nothing. No. Okay, everyone, I know you're back with us. I'm just gonna try and ease our way out of the sighting here. I don't want to give them a fright. I can't see the ones behind us. Andre, will you just tell me if they get up? Well, that's actually ideal. Yes, put in the my rear view mirror. Thank you. Now you can see we are less than 4 feet from them, and they are not in the slightest bit concerned about us. Oh, well, this has been rather easy so far, until we hit a little stick or something. All right, let's go back to Brent. I think he's got a bit more signal.
I think we're here this time. Unfortunately, we've been experiencing a few gremlins, some of those unexplained ones. That's why I just scratched my head and handed over to the technical department, who have greater understandings of zigs and zags and widgets and what pies. I don't understand we have pies. I thought a pie was something you eat. Apparently it's also, what is a pie, Vim?
A tiny computer.
It's a tiny computer. Okay, there we go. Why is it called a pie?
It's a raspberry pie.
It's a raspberry pie. Why is it called a raspberry pie? Oh, that's what. So one of the things that enables us to bring you picture from the middle of the African bush is a raspberry pi. Right, so while we keep checking for Krula, let's go have one last look at those wonderful Nkuhuma cubs with James.
Sorry, I had to show you this, everybody. We are on our way out. The sun is about to dip below the horizon, but I just thought that this little pack of amazing soft, so Tucker, that you can see how soft they are, and they're all just enjoying their own softness just after they've had some milk and possibly a bit of buffalo, and I think that's why they're not playing so much. I think they're very, very full. All right, here we go. All right, Chandri, watch your head. There's a fairly large saffron bush in the way. There's the sun going down, you can say. All right, let's go back to Brent while we get out of here, and we'll see you the other side.
Give James a car for one day. One day, not even two drives, just one drive. and he's managed to break Rusty. How, I'm not sure. Hopefully he does manage to get it started and gets out of the little riverbed there. He has managed to start the car and is now moving, so that's good news. I'm just trying to figure out where Karula's gone. So the kill was just here. We haven't found any tracks of her going north or south, but this is a particularly hard patch after the rain. So I think let's check Ingwe Alley. Leopard Alley. Got to be a leopard in Leopard Alley, surely. Now that is a good question. Khada would like to know, did the word gremlin exist before the movie came out? Is it some form of technical term? Khada, I would be lying if I said I knew the answer to that. Vim? Yeah. I think it could be. It could be one of the words that now exists from the... No, I think it did exist. I think it is a mythological beast. I'm not sure. Maybe why don't you guys double check where gremlin comes from? See if it was named after, became a word after the movie. I do have some sort of fragment in the recesses of my mind that it could be a mythological, could come from a mythological folklore. But so maybe Google that for me and see what, where the word gremlin comes from. And you can send your answers through to questions@wildearth.tv or #SafariLive on Twitter. So I'm hoping Krula has moved into this area. And to look very carefully. Here we go. Come on, Queen Karula. Hi, Safari Ginny. Safari Ginny is wondering about when we're going to get the results of the genetic testing that Panthera's been doing. Ginny, probably not for quite a long time, to be honest. It is an ongoing scientific research project, and they cannot publish those results until they've been reviewed by multiple professors. And so it has to go through peer review. So it's probably going to be a couple of years before that information is available to the public. The paternal study part of the genetic testing is not the main focus and the main reason that is being done. It's actually to have a baseline of leopard genetics for all over Africa. If a skin is confiscated in an airport, they can test the genetics for it to see what area it came from, and that's to aid with conservation in the long haul, which populations of leopards need the most protection. And at the moment, from all the illegal leopard skins out and about that have been confiscated or tested, it seems the majority of those leopards that are being hunted illegally are coming from northern Mozambique and southern Tanzania, which is very, very sad. No sign of Karula. Oh dear. Ben, where do you want to check next? We've been there already today. Want to go to Impala Plains? Vim wants to go to Impala Plains. Should we go to Impala Plains? Yes, we shall. Someone was asking about the sausage tree and how it was handling the drought. I can't remember who it was yesterday before the lion pandemonium. So we're right next to the sausage tree. So I'm sorry, I can't remember who was asking, but we did get slightly distracted after those Nkuhumas leapt upon a lion. I mean, Nkuhumas leapt upon a buffalo. So there's the sausage tree right in front of us. Not looking too bad, still got a bit of greenery on it. I've never seen sausages on the sausage tree in my time here. Maybe this year will be the first time. Well, big thank you to James Dungan. James has got us an answer about where the word gremlins come from. It from the 1920s in the First World War. The airmen, you started using it, the term gremlin, for technical malfunctions on their aircraft. So that's where it comes from. It comes from the British, or the RAF, the Royal Air Force. I would not have suspected that. Now, since it's gambling Sunday and we gambled this morning, let's gamble on a hyena den I haven't been to in an age. Now also, it is a Sunday night. Unfortunately, there will be no fireside chat this evening, but never fear, we shall have Facebook Live this evening. Great to catch up with James. And also, of course, we did have that incredible sighting of the Nkuhumas atop a buffalo last night. Not looking very hopeful. I'm looking at the ground. I don't see many hyena tracks. I see impala and zebra tracks around this hyena den. Oh dear, does not look active. Oh, and the elephants have blocked the way. So there's the hyena den, the Philemon's Dip hyena den, and unfortunately, no hyenas. I really hope the hyenas do come back soon. It'd be great to have the den again. Ooh, that's quite pretty. There we go. Oh, no, I think it was there. That's what I was looking for. There we go. The sun setting through the boughs of a marula tree. Hang on. Very interesting indeed. I think those baboons found Mr. Tingana. So he was just down on the Mwaki River down there. Now I can just hear baboons, bah, bah, alarm calling in the distance. And I'm pretty sure it's those same baboons we saw crossing over our southern boundary. So hopefully, maybe Mr. T will be back on Juma tomorrow. Watch out there, Vim. So while we continue on our nightly endeavors, let's go see James, who's got some avian scavengers.
There's a nice little sort of silhouette. Well, I guess it's not really silhouette if the sun's behind them, but the last of the light on a whole tree full of vultures, and you can see two different species there. Hooded vultures, and those are the little ones, and then the big ones, you can see three of them, left and bottom and right. Those are the white-backed vultures. Most common vulture we have here. And what you must always do when you see a white-backed vulture like this is check to see if it doesn't have a honey-coloured eye. And the reason you do that is that if it's got a honey-coloured eye, it's probably a Cape vulture, which looks almost identical. It is much bigger and often tends to be a little bit paler. But I think these are all white-backed vultures, and they'll be waiting patiently. They are not the eaters of lion dung. They will be waiting for the lions to vacate the premises where the... Well, what's safe? Ooh, there we go. Beautiful. They'll be waiting for the lions to leave the buffalo so that they can go and pick up the scraps. Now, Brooklyn, age 10, you say, aren't they scared of the lions? Yes, they are. That's why they're not... Sorry, one second, everybody. Not confused as to where Gendre was. same place as he was last time I looked. Brooklyn, they are definitely scared of lions, but that's why they sit in the trees. There we are. And they're not on the ground. So if they were not afraid of the lions, they'd all be sitting around that buffalo carcass eating the meat. But you can see they're not doing that now. And that's simply because they are afraid of the lions. They sit up in the tree. There's no way a lion could ever get up that tree unless it was a very good climber. And lions, well, they can climb, but they're not the best climbers in the world. They're not very good at all. Right, now, we're actually parked really close to another Birmingham boy, the fourth one today. And there he is. We saw him from the other side. Remember when we pointed up onto the bank top here? We saw him. Mike, there's another male up here, flat cat. I'm just telling Mike what we're looking at here. He's got very hairy armpits there. And you can see huge paws, roughly the size of my hand. Yeah, Tex, go for it. There's kind of two sightings here. I think make your way straight to the kill site. The cubs are not there, so I think it's perfectly safe. Lots of males around. So the reason it's safe for Tax to come in here and look at the sort of kill site is because there are males. Very few hyenas would take it upon themselves to come into an area like this. So the cubs are very safe while there are big male lions around. And you can see they're spread out all over this place. I don't think that's intentional. I think it's just random. One of them here, one of them up near the cubs, one near the kill site, and I'm not sure where the other one is. There's the one that was at the kill. And the other one probably actually still at Bufusuk Dam. All so tired. And Earl, you're in Tampa and you say if a lion ever caught a vulture, would it eat it? Yeah, look, I think they probably would. They do sometimes eat hyenas if they kill them, but very seldom. Normally they'll leave them alone, and hyenas, of course, the ultimate scavengers, so their flesh is probably relatively toxic, actually. I suspect vultures are probably in a similar sort of a class. I think, you know, the more concentrated your food is, the further away from a bush that it becomes. So, for example, you know, you can eat bushes and you won't have a... You can't poison yourself unless there are lots of poisons in the food. If you eat a lot of meat, however, you can poison yourself because the nutrients are that much more concentrated. There are that many more toxins in meat than there are in... I'm not making any sense here. Let me go again with that. There was some nonsense going on in my ear. Okay, so basically... now I'm just going to pull that out while I try and explain this complicated thing to you. The more towards meat you go, the more toxins there are in the food. So if you're a if you're a herbivore, the chances of you getting poisoned by your food, unless it's something you eat something like tamburti by mistake, which has a specific defensive toxin, the less likely it is that you're going to be poisoned by your food. Meat has a lot more toxins in it, and that's why, for example, carnivore dung smells as appalling as it does compared with, say, herbivore dung. Now, if you go even further down to the sort of what we call tertiary feeders, so animals like jackals and hyenas, which eat a lot of rotting food or scavenging material, you'll find that their flesh will be even more toxic and their dung even more so than that. So I would say, would they eat a vulture? Yes, if they were desperate. Would they by choice? No, I don't think they would. I think it's one of the reasons also that they avoid eating things like bush pigs, which are closely related to our warthogs, but they're omnivorous, they scavenge quite a lot, and they seem to be quite distasteful. He's got a very nice pom-pom, doesn't he? This is not skinny pom-pom. So all four Birmingham boys accounted for, all five lionesses accounted for. No, sorry, I'm talking rubbish. Four lionesses and five cubs. One lioness probably with her cubs somewhere not too far away. Mary Edwards, you say, do lions ever snore? I think I've heard male lions snoring before. I think I've heard them going... Not like dogs. Domestic dogs, I know, snore. And not like rhino. Rhino snore horrifically. It's really funny. If you're tracking them, you can hear them. If they're lying in some mud or something, you hear them inhaling. And then they exhale into the mud and they make a noise and then they're bubbles as well. So it goes... And their huge lips flap together. That lion's not snoring, though. All right, I think we're going to leave him. He's fast asleep, doing not much at all. Sun's gone down. Let's go off and see what we can find. We'll go past Biffleswick Dam and then make our way slowly back sort of towards quarantine clearings. In the meantime, let's head across to Brent Leo Smith and get an update from him as he traverses the twilight.
So as you can see, the sun has dipped below the western horizon. We're hoping to find a late afternoon leap of leopards meandering through Juma somewhere. So we've checked Impala plans, so Viam and I came to an understanding or a compromise. We're going to check Zoe's road, which is a road we haven't checked yet. And Impala, no leopards though. You can see how chilly it is. The Impala are already fluffing up and the sun has just dipped below the horizon. Fluffing up to create that warm insulative blanket around them. Capitalizing on the latest little green flush of grass. Impalalas. And we'll let the impalalas move off. They're probably going to find somewhere relatively open to bed down for the evening. Bud's asking about what sort of happens with the leopard dynamics when Karula hopefully gives a part of her territory to Shongile. And will she continue to expand her territory? Oh, but the sad thing is, as a female leopard gets older, and the more female cubs she has, her territory shrinks. And she's got Shadow, and now to a lesser degree, Salahesh, pushing in. And to the north, there's Nkanyeni, and then they found Shluva, 2005 as well, on Buffalzook this evening. So she's got two leopards covering that section. And then down to the east is also Nkanyeni. So she might try expand, but the likelihood is she'll just stay in a shrunken territory. And she's getting a bit old now. Fighting is not something you want to do if you can help it, if you're a leopard. But you never know, maybe Karula will go fight one of the leopards in the north to expand, or she's unlikely to push back on Shadow, as it's one of her daughters, and she's unlikely to push back on Tandi, as another one of her daughters. So it's going to be very interesting to see what happens if Shongile makes it to adulthood. Now I say if, because before leopards are a year old, they run about a 70 to 75% mortality rate. So there is still, in 6 months, still a good chance that either of those cubs might meet an unfortunate end. Of course, that's the last thing we want, but it is possible. We are dealing with nature, and nature is unpredictable. Nature can be mean, and nature can be unfair and brutal. But it is survival of the fittest out here in the African bush. And we saw that so perfectly last night. And I've watched that clip again of that buffalo. And those of you on the Sunrise Safari, I saw that buffalo. And I looked at him and I said, oh, he looks very mean and grumpy. And he had it injured, what was it, left eye. And a bit of a limp and a stiff walk. And that's probably why the Nkumas chose him. He wasn't in the top condition. And that's a culmination of him being quite old and the drought that we're experiencing at the moment. But he had to die so the little lion cubs could live. Amelia would like to know, if I had a choice, would I shoot and kill the buffalo to end its suffering? Amelia, the answer is an emphatic no. It's not my place to get involved. I'm an observer here in nature, and human beings, and I do love this phrase, human beings often try to be gardeners in nature. We've got this system that works so well, and everything has its own little niche, and like a big cog, and everything just fits perfectly. A well-oiled, well-balanced machine, including drought and flood, and we just want to change it. We think we can make it better, and in the end of the day, we make it worse. For example, if we had to shoot that buffalo while it was bellowing, those Birmingham boys wouldn't have known that there was a free meal to be had. So there's a reason for all these different things, and it's a very human thing to focus on a very small part of the system, like that buffalo suffering. But you've got to sort of step back and look at it from above if you can, and or from a distance. So a buffalo belling, it tells the male lions the females have made a kill. It might tell the hyena clan that there's something that they might go challenge for. So there's reasons for these things and reasons why they happen. Not my place to interfere. Where are all the leopards? That is the question I'd love to know the answer to. I'm gonna pop down towards Galago Pan. Maybe we'll have some luck around there. But there's a good chance Mr. Tingana is going to come back tonight. Hopefully he doesn't stroll straight through the property. Hopefully he catches a nice big impala and puts it in a tree. Oh, chilly. No, no leopards crossing behind us. That happened to us a few times with Karula a few days ago. We'd drive past, she'd come behind us. I always just want to check the road behind us. No, don't worry, no leopards crossing behind us. Let's go check around Gallagher. Now the other thing is that with all these puddles around at the moment, the leopards aren't being forced to the permanent water holes. So it does make it a little more challenging. But I just can't believe we haven't seen any tracks of Karula. I think tomorrow, if there's still no tracks on the Sunrise Safari, I'm gonna have to go take a stroll into the drainage line and see if I can conjure up a leopard cub or two. Hi, Dolly. Dolly would like to know, do leopards recognize their own siblings? I think they possibly do to a degree, Dolly. It doesn't mean they're not going to fight with their siblings once they reach adulthood because they've been encroaching on each other's territory. But I think there is a possibility they will recognize their siblings. I definitely think the females recognize their offspring. And while we keep searching for these invisible leopards, let's go see what James is up to.
Right, well, we're back again, everybody, and we found nothing so far. But I must just say to you, as we drive through here, another change in my 14 days away, or 16 days, or whatever it was. The Cambritum trees have now lost their leaves, and the leaf litter underneath. It's a lovely kind of cinnamon-scented, as Brian put it, cinnamon-scented kind of potpourri on the ground. So it is a lot more open than it was when I left here. I've got my leggy blanket on because it is quite cold now. And I think I've got a fairly similar idea to Brent's in that we're going to head down towards the Mawati drainage and see if we can't pick up tracks. Well, can't really track in this light, but we might be lucky and pick up Karula and her little ones, who I haven't seen for so long. Ah, now James Richard, a very good question, and one that's actually quite easy to answer for once. You say, which tree species will get their buds first, and when can we expect their new leaves? Well, the first tree species to sprout are going to be these knob thorns, and what they sprout are their flowers. Very subtly scented honey-coloured flowers, and they'll get them probably sort of early-ish September. A few of them, I mean one or two now, ridiculous though. Then a few in August, and then September they will get their flowers, and they will then get their leaves after that. Now James, what happens with the trees is that they react far more to day length than they do to water. So you've seen that there is a little bit of greenery that's popped up as a result of that rain that we had, and that's the grasses. But the trees don't react like that to rain at all. You can see there's absolutely no change in them at all. They react entirely almost to, well, it's a combination of water and to day length, but it's largely day length that they are reacting to. So knobthorns, first sign of spring is there, and I don't even want to talk about it yet because we're still at least a month away from it. But it's knobthorns that are going to produce their little honey-coloured yellow flowers first, and they're just so lovely smelling. But I love this time of year. I really enjoy because it is a time of expectation. There's a crested barbet up there. There it is. There it is. There it is. It was the right side of the branch. It is, there we go. There is a beautiful crested barbet. Darlene, you want to know about impala lilies, which are lovely pink flowers, everybody, that come up from succulent branches. Darlene, I'm not sure that I've seen any here. I feel like I have, but I don't know where they are. They're not common here at all. They're like sodic soils. We'd probably find them on Cheetah Plains quite a lot more than we'd find them here. They should be flowering round about now. And so, yeah, I guess we could see some. I haven't seen any at Juma, but I reckon that there must be some around. Not many, but at Cheetah Plains and those big clearings, we'll probably find some quite nice impala lilies. Beautiful pink and sort of candy-colored flowers. Remember candy stripes? Just like that. And the last of the drongos are calling. A couple of pearl-spotted owls. No, that was a drongo doing a pearl-spotted owl, which I'm not going to stop for because they're in the distance. You won't hear them. And of course the white-browed scrub robins making their calls. A couple of babblers going quack, 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 quack. Babbling away at each other. And a lovely smell. That's the other reason I love this time of year. Just have a smell, everybody. Shut your eyes. And take a deep breath in through your nose. The problem, unfortunately, now that we're not moving, is that all I can smell is my jersey. Which is actually more like a really dirty, wet Labrador. And Lady Macbeth, you're absolutely right. Fever tree flowers, you say, smell like cooking donuts. They do. But if I can get away from my jersey, there is a freshness of it because of the rain, and this kind of cinnamony smell of the leaf litter is being released, I think, by the moisture in the soil. This is much better once we're moving. Ah, yes. Now only Gendre can smell my jersey. I'll have to put it into the wash as soon as I get back. Ugh. Really not delicious at all. And amazing how much warmer it is in this part of the country than it is just about anywhere else. Down in the Eastern Cape, the temperatures are not totally dissimilar, but because the air is moister and there tends to be a bit more wind and a bit more rain, especially this time of year, it feels so much colder. And Johannesburg, where I was, very cold indeed. I have a cold shower here every morning, just a very fast one. Just to wake up, because of course we get up quite early in the morning. In Johannesburg, I tried it once, I didn't try it again. It was, impossible. And then in Natal as well, frosty mornings, very cold. Lovely, thank you, Jeffrey in Texas. The theme of a vile stink. Let's just get. There were two vultures beautifully silhouetted on this tree. Unfortunately, I failed to notice them in time. There they are, and they're now silhouetted on another tree. Isn't that nice of me, Gendre, to give you that? Jeffrey, you say that you have flowers there in Texas that smell like dirty diapers. Thank you, Jeffrey. That's disgusting, of course. I hope you have other flowers in Texas that don't only smell of dirty diapers. The song The Yellow Rose of Texas comes to mind, and one hopes that the Yellow Rose of Texas didn't smell like a soiled diaper. Not so, Gendre. Yes. Oh, those are white-backed vultures, the bigger vultures, and they'll be waiting for those lions to move off before they go back down to the buffalo. They won't go during the night, mainly because they find it very difficult to fly, and also because they are diurnal. They don't see so good at night time, and I think it'd be very easy for a lion to swat them if they got anywhere near the kill. They stand probably about, a white-backed vulture, about that high. So say 2 and a bit feet, two and a bit feet. And 2 and a bit, you still got them. 2 and a bit feet, of course, is very small in comparison with a lion. There they go. Wonderful. Lion's much bigger than that. So they really wouldn't stand a chance were a lion to come anywhere near them. Their only defense would be to fly away, and that's, like I say, very difficult at night. So we've come basically around where the lions are. They're quite a long way off into the drainage system there, but these vultures, especially the white-backed, they'll watch the kill site from a long way off, and they don't need to worry about getting too close to it. They know the lions are there, so they'll just wait around, even though they are quite a distance from it. Ah, thank you, Jeffrey. You say that your stinky plant in Texas is called a dwarf olive tree, and it does stink, you say. Yes, well, I'm glad that it's only one species and not all the trees of Texas. Right, we're going through the Mwati drainage now. Ooh. Oh, it's a diker. There's a Franklin diker there, but they're not seeable. I suppose I should put some lights on. There we go. Light. Ooh, and a lovely smell of potato bush Phyllanthus reticulatus. Let me find you one. They're almost impossible to find unless you know where they are. Can you see one, Jandre? And all you can smell is my jersey, Jandre. I do apologize. There's one there. I apologize profusely for the fact that I smell like a Labrador who has had a bath 3 weeks ago. Come over here. Follow me, everybody. Now, Rebecca says she has never smelt this plant, but it's this thing here. It's this rather scraggly bush. This is actually one plant, and it's called Phyllanthus reticulatus, or the potato bush. And I have very, very seldom managed to pick the plant and smell the potatoes. But this whole, there we go. There's a little bit in here, and it's a flower, but it's a totally indistinct flower that smells like potatoes. And there you can kind of see one there. Does that work for you, Jandry? Too hectic. How's that? Just in there, where my baby finger is, can you see that? There's a flower there. And it smells like potatoes, just like a McDonald's. Rebecca, I'm going to have to find you a better one. I was going to bring this for you, but it doesn't smell nearly enough. Anyway, that's the potato bush. Scraggly thing. Ah, it's a lovely smell of this time of the year. Reminiscent of very good times in the bush. Romantic times, of course. Them was the days, Jandre, before I became old and decrepit. Oh, Marianne, not an easy one to answer. I'll have a guess for you. You say, how many species of succulents are there here? very many. I mean, we've got the Impala lilies, obviously. We've got a... What else have we got? Not much else. I suppose you might consider the baboon's tail might be considered a succulent, but if you cut them open, they're not really, actually. They're quite dry inside. What else? There's something called a Portuguese... I can only remember the botanical name. It's called a carrion bush. The carrion bush is quite succulent. It smells like rotting flesh. So that's quite a good one. But otherwise, not a great deal of succulents out here. We're in what we call a semi-arid area. I'm definitely missing out a few of them, but they're not that many. And we're in what we call a semi-arid area, which means that we get about, say, 18 inches of rain a year, plus minus 18 to 24 inches of rain a year. And any drier than this, you get into the arid regions. Those will be up into the sort of the Kalahari, Botswana, and then those sort of arid regions, you find a few more succulents, and then into the proper desert regions of the northern Kalahari and into the Namib, then you're going to find largely the plants there will be succulent or xerophytic. But no, not that many here. I'm sure I'll think of a few maybe. That's interesting. Gerda, you say along the northern Kruger when you were there, there was something called a zebra sweat bush, which stank quite a bit. I suspect, Gerda, that is also known as the per de pus bush, or the horse's urine bush, or the name has completely lost me, but Bushman's grape. And we do get those here, and if we find one, I'll show you. I'm sure you've seen it, but so you'll be able to tell me if that's the same plant or not. Let's head it back across to Brent, see what he's found. I'm going to continue smelling my way into the night.
Well, I am in search of anything, really. It's been a bit of a quiet sunset safari for VM and I. We've thoroughly enjoyed it there. Explored parts of Arethusa that we haven't been to for a while. All those fish eagles at the Arethusa Dam. Now I'm hoping for any nocturnal critter. I'm still searching for Karula. I have not given up on that endeavor just yet. Checking her usual haunts. Hi Callum, Callum is a brand new viewer. Welcome to Safari Live, Callum. Callum has a request for an owl. Okay Callum, I'll try my best to find you an owl. I think I've got a good idea about where to find one. So I'll start making my way there. We might even find an owlet, which is just the small owl. Might find some bush babies. Oh, I'm just gonna not put the, oh no, he's running, darn it. But it was so fun, I wasn't gonna put the light on him, but on top of the termite mound, there was a diker sitting next to one of the, oh sorry, Vim, next to one of the termites' open air tunnels, so it was trying to get warmth from the termite mound. Clever diker. I think tonight's gonna be a very cold night. Tomorrow morning, it's going to be bitterly cold. So a good place to look for owls is in dead trees. Like some of the owl species we get are quite big, so they like to sit on a more open perch, just like a vulture would or an eagle. it is great to have Commander Bond back from holiday. A very entertaining human he is, and great to have him in camp. Quite scary that we've actually known each other for over 10 years now. So we saw something quite strange a few nights ago, and that was the Varroes, or giant eagle owl, sitting in the Warburg's eagle's nest on Warburg's Eagle Road. So definitely gonna pop past there before the end of drive to see if it's still there. I think it might have just been found it a good spot to have a sit down. I'm not convinced it was nesting in that nest. I hope it's nesting in that nest, but I'm not convinced just yet. Chilly. Now hopefully we find tracks of Karula on tomorrow's sunrise safari. She makes an appearance, or even be nice to see Tingana. I haven't seen him in quite a while. I know Jamie saw him last week, but I haven't seen that big boy for quite some time. Okay, we're about 2 minutes away from where we found that owl. So, Callum, hopefully we'll find an owl for you. So that nest that the owl was utilizing is just at the end of the road here. So at the edge of my light, so let's hope that that owl is still there. Or was decided to utilize that tree again. I doubt it's been sitting there for a week. Here we go, we're arriving at the tree. Is there an owl sitting in the Warburg's eagle's nest? Let's just see if we can get a side angle on it. Unfortunately, no owl this evening. So that's where it was. It was worth a try. That said, thanks for trying. So from Viam and myself, it's great to have Viam and James back. Brian will be back shortly as well, and so will Steph. So great to have all some of the team coming back and the rest of the team going on well-deserved breaks. And from Viam and myself, we'll see you in a few short hours for the Sunrise Safari. Hopefully our leopard luck is a bit better.
Hello again, everybody. I'm now using my magnificent spotlighting technique to find creatures of the night. I have not found creatures of the night, but we might be able to get you a very nice silhouette. Hang on 1 second. Of some... I nearly said horses. Ha ha ha. Zebra. Hendry, is there any silhouette? Can you see them? They're just come. I think I've gone too far. There was quite an. Yes, they are. There we go. Can you is it? That's hopeless, isn't it? Oh, beautiful sighting I've made for you there. Patricia, let's move on from here. You say, are the smells of plants there to deter animals? No, they're quite the opposite. They're there to attract animals that would pollinate them. So even plants that smell disgusting, like Jeffrey's diaper bush or our carrion bush here, carrion flower, which smells like rotting meat, that's because it attracts things that are attracted to rotting meat or dirty diapers in the case of the dwarf olive bush of Texas. So there probably are various carrion eating moths that would perhaps eat or go and sit on I don't think it is moths, I think it's probably dung beetles. Various kinds of flesh-eating beetles that would go towards a carrion plant, and is called Stapelia, that's what it's called, Stapelia gigantica. They would go into the plant, probably then be covered in the pollen, and then they'd go off towards, here comes another zebra, I'm just going to let them run past us, they're getting a little bit nervous. So the flesh-eating beetle would go towards the Stapelia plant, walk around on it, not find any food, but in the process deposited with pollen, it would then go to another one, and in the same way that a bee pollinates a flower, so the flesh-eating beetle would do that with a carrion-eating plant. Yeah, the zebras have gone, but they are in front of us, we're not going to shine on them, I'm just going to give them a chance to move away before they get scared of us. They're just standing there now, so they're going to have to move out the way or get a fright. They're moving up into the clearings, as many of the animals do during the night. We retrieve the spotlight so that we might see some creatures. No, this zebra running in front of us. Thank you to all of you for your very kind welcome backs. I know this looks ridiculous. I'm just stopping because the zebras are running sort of stunned by the light, if you like. So I'm just trying to let them get past. Yeah, beautiful shot there, Hendry, of the sunset with the giraffe-shaped bush to the left-hand side of the picture. There it is. Well done. And thank you to all of you for your very kind welcome backs. It's very nice to be back. Well, there we go. Listen. Shouting at each other. Why? That's normally an alarm call, but I don't think it is now. They don't seem to be being assailed by lions. You can hear them now. They're running off there. There you go. And off they go. Alright everybody, that's going to be it from us this evening, unless something profound happens in the next 30 seconds. Thank you, Hendry, for coming along on my ride back. Thank you very much. Big thank you to Rebecca, the heartless redhead in the final control as well. I didn't say that, that's how Rebecca described her. And of course, to all of you, wonderful to be back with all of you here in the wonders of the African wild. We'll see you tomorrow at Hopper 6. Bye-bye.
had an epic cheetah sighting, sort of climbing up fallen marulas, scent marking or chasing something. So that is still in the pipeline, of course. I have no doubt that the killer bees will have one of those sightings in the near future. Okay. Last sip of my tea. It's warmed up quite nicely. Hello, suspicious primate. Suspicious primate would like to know what type of tea I'm drinking. Did you see it, Brian? On top of this little... Oh, is he flown? He's flown, don't worry. It was a little battus. Let's see if we can spot him in the next tree. But suspicious primate's wondering what type of tea am I drinking? Is it made from local plants? Now, the only time I drink a tea that is made from local plants is when I'm getting a cold or a flu. Then I will harvest a plant called Lipia javanica. Now, Lipia javanica is also known as Bushman's fever tea or wild mint. It smells very minty, of course, and you use that with honey in it. It's a really good preventative as soon as you start feeling a little bit cold or flu-y. But other than that, no, I'm afraid my tea this morning is quite boring. Earl Grey, been around for a while. I'm not actually sure of the origins of Earl Grey tea, but where James and I used to work, there used to be a butler, and he had a bit of problems with the pronunciation of Earl Grey. So it was known to us for many years and still quite often called by us, instead of Earl Grey, it's called Early Grey. You only have Early Grey in the morning. So old December thought that it was Early Grey, and it doesn't matter how many times we tried to tell him it was Earl Grey, it was never going to be Earl Grey, it was only going to be Early Grey. There we go, final control, doing a little bit of research for me. Earl Grey was apparently named after a guy called Charles Grey, and maybe he came up with the blend. But the Earl Grey was the second Prime Minister in the 1800s. I think I heard that correct. 1830s, there we go. Hey, see, that's the wonderful thing. That's a new knowledge for me. But that's the wonderful thing about being out here, you do learn constantly. And we're going to continue heading towards the western sections of Cheetah Plains. While we do that, let's go see how Jamie's faring on Juma.
We are right in the middle of Juma, on Central Road to be exact, and as Central Road suggests, it is in the centre. I hear that Brent's been discussing his morning tea. I don't know whether or not he realises, because I know, because I made him his tea, that it wasn't in fact Earl Grey at all. I'm not sure whether his refined tea taste buds have picked up on that fact or not, but there definitely wasn't any Earl Grey in there. That was solid, good quality South African blend, normal tea, black tea. Right, now I hear a report that there are some very large, very grey animals somewhere just along this road. I am, of course, referring to elephants and nothing else. Let's just keep our eyes peeled for them. I would really enjoy a nice elephant sighting at this stage. We've had our lion and he has escaped us. And poor old Maggie is probably feeling a little bit the worse for the wear. And every now and again, Jandre and I double check to see that the tires are still vaguely, vaguely pumped up. Let's go see what's standing on the termite mound. It looks like a buffalo. So not the large grey thing we were looking for, but a large brown thing. The wonderful thing about termite mounds, though, is that they give us a very different perspective on the animals that we see. Don't go running off now, boy. Okay, we've stopped. I know we're a very subtle approach that we made there. There's a figure that you would definitely not want to see bearing down upon you. An important lesson in making sure that you always check what's on the other side of the termite mound before you climb it. Because you never know what you might encounter on the other side. And a grumpy buffalo bull is definitely high up on the list of encounters one would like to avoid on a Sunday morning. Now, he's up on the termite mound because termites, as you can imagine, when they dig up from the depths of the earth, they bring that soil up from underneath the ground. They bring with it all of the nutrients that have been sheltered there for decades. And that means that very often you'll find good species of grass growing up on termite mounds, as well as some more nutritious trees. And just have a look. I don't actually even know if Jean Ray can get this other buffalo. Can you get him there, or is he in completely the wrong place for that bar? Things are a bit more tricky on our makeshift, Mahendra. Here we go, just look at this. Buffalo are, by nature, bulk grazers. In other words, they eat grass. Although, in times like these, their digestive systems just have to learn to cope with other things. In this case, a weeping wattle tree, which actually on its own is not even all that nutritious. And it just goes to show how desperately these animals are fighting for survival at this point. They, even if that includes changing their diet, not completely, but certainly supplementing. And it's not often you get to see a buffalo's tongue coming out and wrapping around tree leaves. That's because in general, they don't eat them. They might, even in summer, nibble on the odd apple leaf, but it's very rare to see a buffalo targeting quite so enthusiastically a tree rather than a patch of grass. But then, who can blame him? Because I'm not sure I would want to snack on the grass in its current state. Not that I'm a huge grass eater myself, but there's really nothing to eat, and it's not very appetizing at all. Now, a couple of days ago, and I still haven't relocated this particular buffalo calf that we saw, but a couple of days ago we had the most extraordinary sighting, Brian and myself, that we ended up being incredibly emotionally invested in, which was a young buffalo whose mother was struggling to get up and right herself after the birth of after giving birth to this little calf. And this poor little calf was so desperate, it was trying to suckle from a neighboring buffalo bull, which obviously wasn't met with much happiness on the part of the bull. Now, Tony, in terms of what's going to happen with all babies in the next few months, you were wondering if there's going to be less young born later, or if the young born are going to be weaker. I think that's probably going to differ from species to species. Impala, the wildebeest, the warthogs, all of which have a very strict breeding season. There's a story that impala can delay their giving birth in order to wait for the rains. It's not true. It's just because not all of them fall pregnant at exactly the same time. So it just depends on that season when they're all going to give birth and when they mated exactly to when they're going to give birth. I think impala's young are going to be fine. I've just realized how much there is in terms of leaf litter in the vehicle with me at the moment. Maggie is now full of leaves. Mr. Buffalo, I'm not sure if, no, those are sort of meager offerings. Less babies, yes, probably. Weaker babies, yes, most likely. Elephants, buffalo, The bigger animals that are really going to struggle, I would say that they're going to be the ones that suffer the most. Warthog, you're going to see less offspring making it to full term, and less offspring even surviving once they have been born. So those are the animals that are going to suffer the most, I think. I think impala babies are going to be the same. Maybe a little bit less, because the poor females, you can imagine the impact that a pregnancy has on their resources. Let me try that one more time. Sorry, Kirsten. Give me a second. Okay, repeat, please. There we go. Okay, we need to send you across to Brent. It's getting a bit jumpy on our side. We need to reboot.
Well, welcome back. We've decided to check the western sections. Unfortunately, it doesn't look like quarantine has crossed around here. As I say that, now that confuses me a lot. they have right on our boundary, unfortunately, on our western boundary of Cheetah Plains. It's a crossword puzzle, we're not even going to start. We have a look. Let me try to find a nice one. I think they are quite old, not old, yesterday. You see that there, Brian? Oh, you see the very distinct, let me get on the right side of the sun. Three lobes at the back, but a very long and narrow foot. And then at the tip, you can see there, two little claw marks. Now, this is not a male cheetah. This is a female cheetah. And we were asked about a female cheetah this morning. But she's managed to sneak through without anyone seeing her. And right across our western boundary in Cheetah Plains. I'd say she crossed here last night, probably, or last night, or late evening last night. Came from there. Very interesting. Oh, wait, what was that? Hyena tracks. Very interesting. This is a crossword we're not even going to start because it will only last about 10 meters. I've just got a gut feeling, and Brian agrees, that we're going to meander our way back to three in a row pan. As it's got a bit warmer, possibly something might come to drink. Ellie's, buffalo, maybe some zebra, but hopefully one of the cats as well. Have a look. Yeah. This is an area of Cheetah Plains we don't spend too much time in. It's very, very thick. And I like to just come down here every now and then, have a squiz what's going on. I mean, look at that, a female cheetah went through here. But while we head back towards three in a row pan, Jamie has found something very large to show you.
Here we go. This is what we set out for before we got distracted by the buffalo on a termite mound. Elaine, and to all of our other elephant lovers, this is a sighting for you. And it's actually spectacular. Of course, I can't see, and Maggie, what you are looking at in terms of lighting, but from my perspective, it is absolutely beautiful. Just these enormous grey shapes hidden in the bright, bright green of the spike thorn thicket, and is just absolutely stunning. It's one of my favorite places to see elephants in sitting in river systems like this. What do you think, the gill? It's okay. It's okay. You can come across if you want. I'm doing some serious thinking there. Twisting her trunk a little bit, just sniffing the air. Oh, cute. Is this why she's so nervous? Oh, no, it's the little wrinkly foreheaded one. It's Benjamin Button. Ah, I'm so glad we got to see this little thing. Hello, hello. All right, big girl. Sorry. We don't mean any harm to your little baby. Oh, hello. Oh, Speedwobble. Oh, goodness. Hey, big girl. Hi. Your baby's beautiful. Your baby is beautiful. Even if it has got a wrinkly forehead. Hey, baby. The baby that is only just a couple of weeks, if that, old. Brent named something ridiculous like Old Before His Time, and one of the other viewers had a much better idea and called it Benjamin Button, just because of its wrinkly forehead. Oh, hello. Oh, we're surrounded by them. Sorry, I know that this is really awkward for genre here. Very difficult position. Hello, big girl. Hi. Your baby is absolutely gorgeous. And I understand that you're feeling very protective because you're a young mom, youngish mom, and this little baby is absolutely minute. It's the wrinkliest baby elephant I ever did see. I know you can't see it at the moment because it's hiding behind mom, but it really is the wrinkliest baby elephant I have ever seen. It's incredible. Hello, Benjamin, hiding behind mommy there. We don't see you, but we will in a moment. Poor Gendre attempting to... Hello, big girl. It's okay. Yeah, Gendre says nope, sorry. Okay. Sorry, Gendre. That elephant chose the worst possible position to walk behind in terms of our abilities on the Mahindra. I just want to watch where she's gone. I can't see either, so, you know. Maggie maybe doesn't make for the best visibility in the world. Where has she gone? I can't see her at all. Okay, she's on your side, okay. I prefer to be able to see what the elephants are doing around me, particularly new moms. Not that she's in any way stressed out. Is she far enough away? Perfect, thank you. Gendre says we can reposition. I'm just going to change my angle here so that I can see what's happening. She is walking away from us. So I'm just going to let her get a little bit further because her baby's separate from her for now. The trick. One day we're going to get a shot with this side mirror with an elephant in it. That's because it's fantastically says object in the mirror may be closer than they appear. Which is a comforting thought when you're using it to look for elephants. Okay, there we go, she's turned around. So we can turn around. Absolutely. I'm so thrilled I got to see this little baby elephant. I heard so much about it. Brent told me he came home from the drive. And it just sounded so adorable. And now I can see exactly what it means. Ooh. Let's try to turn around in here. The signal might break up a little bit. But we should be back to normal soon. Beautifully relaxed herd of elephants. Can you see some of them through there, Gendre? Perfect. Let's stop and have a quick look at them snacking on the spike thorn thicket. Not very appetizing. We saw the buffalo feeding on the weeping wattle. Spike thorns like silver cluster leaves. Incredibly high in tannin content, which means they taste very astringent. And they will suck away all of your saliva if you munch on them as a human being. Great for upset stomachs. Not so much for the taste that they leave in your mouth. It's my pom-pom getting in the way there. I'm trying to duck it out of the way. It's very tricky when you can't... I'm not used to the angles. Now it's in the way. My apologies. I can't escape Chandra. Here we go. An elephant deciding that it's tired of the spike thorn diet. Time to move on and see what else it can find. I'm keeping an eye out for our little one. I want to show you another view of Benjamin Button. Definitely by one of the cutest baby elephants I have ever seen. And since our ellies are a bit obscured here, let's try for one more view. Such a tiny little one. Good point from Shamsun, saying that I do smell like lion, would it not bother the elephants? The whole area at the moment, Shamsun, smells like lion. This is where the female was keeping her cubs. The males have moved in. Oh, there's a gentle squeak from Maggie now. A complaint after all of my off-roading. Oh, get a big stick. Shamsun, yes, it could bother the Ellie slightly. Oh, what is that little one doing? Can you see it there, Jandre? Little bit of curiosity there. Exploring its new world. And trunk not quite coordinated enough to fully master it. Might actually be eating Mom's dung as well, which they do for the antibodies and the bacteria that it will need in the future. So baby elephants do occasionally eat their mother's dung. Oh, that's cute. So Shamsun, I don't think it's me that smells like lion urine, I hope. We'll find out when I actually get off. I think Maggie took the brunt of it. Might be all over Maggie's side mirror. Yes, it could potentially bother the elephants if it was an unexpected smell. But as I said, the whole area at the moment smells like lion. It doesn't appear to be bothering them at all. But we are very, very cautious of our impact in those sorts of way. Or if the elephants are showing us any sign of unhappiness, then immediately we would have moved away. But she is quite comfortable with us. And her little wrinkly baby, which is just too cute. It's like its skin is two sizes too big for it. Aqua, well done, by the way, Aqua, bravo on the name Benji, our Benjamin Button elephant. I think that is a brilliant name. Aqua, it would be wonderful to watch Benji grow up and fill out his wrinkles, which he would of course do, but I completely agree with you. I'd love to know what caused it. He looks like he's inherited a second-hand skin. Like he's got an older cousin and it's just been a hand-me-down. It really is too sweet, but I agree. And the joys of Safari Live is that we might be able to identify. I don't know how quickly those wrinkles are going to disappear or how easy he's going to be in future. So why don't we have a look at Mom? Because he's going to be with Mom, very close with Mom, for at least the next 3 years of his life. But let's have a look at her identifying features, so that we know in future when we are looking at Benji the little wrinkly elephant. Sounds like the title to a children's book, doesn't it? So she's got a little nick flap on the outside of her ear. Oh, crunch. That's about her only identifying feature on that ear that we can see at this perspective or from this angle. She's got two relatively uniform tusks. One right, one slightly pointier, but that always changes because they break. So the outline of the ear is one of the best ways of sort of an on-spec identification of an elephant, because those nicks and cuts and imperfections will remain that way for the rest of their lives. And the car's about to rock a little bit. It's not Jean-André's fault. His camera work is perfect as always. I'm taking my foot off the brake, which I should have done ages ago. Oh. Well, that was, yes, that was very dramatic. I thought we were going to roll back further. And she's currently enjoying an entire... And that is a root that she's just pulled out there. She's dug up and pulled out a root system of what looks like it was a monkey thorn, or something similar, and she is now crunching her way through it. So not even as they do with a stick or a piece of trunk, not aiming for the cambium layer of the bark, she's crunching the root, the entire root, because it contains, as you know, root is a storage system for a plant, so it contains a great deal of nutrients as well as water and nitrates, because as herbivores they do need to supplement their protein intake. The nitrates in the rhizomes of the various plants, particularly acacias and their relatives, provide them with the protein or the nitrates that proteins would otherwise provide in meat eaters and carnivores or omnivores. Her little one, Benji, is just being the cutest thing that ever walked the face of the planet. I know we were discussing lion cubs and that they are cuter than anything else. I'm pretty sure that because we're currently looking at him, Benji might win that title. But he doesn't want to be looked at anymore. He wants to do yoga behind Mom, which is fair enough. Do some morning stretches. Do some trunk coordination learning. We've all got different impressions of what our little baby elephant looks like. And Maurice says that it looks as though she left the baby in the bath for too long. It's gone all pruney, like our fingers and our toes do. I think that's a brilliant comparison. Mommy, how did you get your baby so wrinkly? What on earth caused that? Oh, kneeling down. Imitating Mom. And Shamsun, no, I don't think his wrinkles are from dehydration, although I can see what you mean. That might have been a little bit of concern. But no, she seems to be, just looking at her a little bit, she seems to be lactating. I don't think it's from dehydration. I think this, and if a baby elephant was dehydrated to the extent that its skin was wrinkling, it certainly wouldn't have the same degree of energy that our little one is displaying at the moment. So I don't think we need to be worried, although that was a good point. It was a good suggestion. Because baby elephants in this time of drought might be struggling if their mom's not producing enough milk, particularly a young mom, as ours is here. But at the moment, you can see that curiosity, attempting to learn how to pull up grass stems with its trunk, this bizarre protrusion on the end of its face that it has to come, that he has to come to grips with and learn how to use. And at the moment, that is occupying his current fixation. Is that blade of grass that's there. Oh, she's nearly eaten, while we've been looking at her gorgeous baby, she's nearly eaten that entire root, crunching her way through it. Oops, tired of that now. You dropped it, girl. It's there. This little one wobbles its way around underneath Mom's tummy and attempts to kick up whatever it can find and then pick it up with its trunk. It isn't going terribly well at the moment. Kathy, our little one here, once he's stopped sucking his trunk for comfort. Oh, there's Mommy. Come on, Mommy. Let Benji have a drink. Our little one will start eating solid food at around 6 months of age, is when you start to see them prop. Oh, Mommy, come on. It's your little one. You know, I said she looked like she was lactating. She actually doesn't look like she's lactating that much. The mammaries don't look as large as they might otherwise. But it might just be because she's young. It might just be because she's young and small. She is letting the little one try and feed now, but she's just distracted by the roots. But Kathy, 6 months of age is the age at which they start to properly supplement. They will put other things in their mouths before that and occasionally chew and swallow them, kind of like toddlers and any object that you don't want them to put in their mouth and chew and swallow. Baby elephants are much the same, and they often watch Mom or older cousins or siblings to attempt to... Here we go. Here we go, little one. Round you go. There we are. Except Mom won't really keep still because Mom's hungry. She's decided that she wants food first. As the poor little Benji attempts to latch on at the same time and dodge the kicking feet. And then water. Well, we've seen them drink water at about 3 or 4 months of age. They'll start to drink that. But mostly they will be entirely reliant upon their mother's milk, and she will lactate for up to 3 years after giving birth. And then comes the full-on process of weaning, which is not something that's appreciated by little baby elephants, nor in fact baby hyenas, which we were talking about earlier. And they start to have proper full-on weaning tantrums where they scream at their mothers. And a lot of the vocalizations that we hear come from screaming baby elephants being told they can't drink milk anymore. She is definitely thoroughly focused on something in here. She's trying to kick away the trees so she can get to the root system. Using a combination, mainly she's using her feet to dig, which is why poor Benji can't get in to have a drink. Ooh. And he's not winning at all because she really, really wants whatever's underneath here. But once she's finished with this, then she will allow him to suckle. It's just because she needs her front legs. Elephants, apart from primates, are the only animals out here with pectoral nipples, pectoral mammary glands. It's making life tricky. Benjamin? Benjamin's the elephant. Don. Sorry. I got distracted by the elephant. Don, not Benjamin. Don would like to know how much I think Benjamin weighs. I'd say he would top out the scale at around, even though he looks so incredibly tiny, probably around close to 200 pounds, if not a little bit more. He's very, very young still. And it's not a big elephant calf, but they're usually born just under or around 100 kilograms, so close to 200, 220 pounds. So Benjamin will be a little bit bigger than that. So although he looks tiny, I suppose everything looks tiny in comparison to a couple of tons worth of Mom. Ah, there we go. Well done, Mom. I mentioned that she is quite a young mother. This could well be her first calf. Although I'm starting to think perhaps second, because she has had a young elephant hanging out with her the entire time that we've been here. And the elephants do maintain their bond with their offspring. Hello. Oh, little one. That wasn't a very big drink, was it? It was not a very big drink. No. Oh, watch out. Watch out, that's a dangerous spot to be in. Davina, you wanted to know... I've forgotten what you wanted to know. I've got completely distracted by the elephant calf and by the approaching vehicle. Sorry. Oh, that's what we were talking about. That's why we were talking about why the mom is young. You wanted to know what age they have start to have babies. And she's given up on the idea of digging. She's now going to push the tree over entirely, or is thinking about it. At their earliest, they reach sexual maturity at around 12 or so. And they can have their first calf that young, about 12, 13. That's when puberty hits, or sexual maturity hits. It often takes a little bit longer for them to go into a true estrus and to be fully fertile and to give birth. Between 12 to 15 years of age is usually when a female has her first offspring. Our young elephant cow that's digging away here, she's probably under 20 years old. Oh, being a bit protective of her little one, chasing the other slightly older elephant away. But she is absolutely determined to get to the root system of this tree. And what we're watching in a way is quite sad, because there's a certain level of desperation for the elephants. They've got to spend this amount of time and put this amount of focus into searching for the nutrition that they need. Hello, Benji. You cute. Can't quite understand why Mom is so focused. You really are just the sweetest little thing. Oh! She's kicking away at the roots and at the same time trying... Benji's getting in the way a little bit of her intently focused work, but she's finally... Oh, ouch. That looked sore. It snapped sooner than she expected it to. She's finally managed to pull some of the root system free.